Welcome to Huntington, West Virginia. Nobody's sleeping in today here. It's a tailgate breakfast on the menu for a game Thundering Herd faithful have been waiting for. Earlier this morning, the Marshall squad walked to the stadium through a throng of supporters, ready for a visit from perennial power Kansas State. It's the most anticipated home game in school history. Marshall and K-State breakfast in college football are served. Will be thundering. Marshall's young upstarts will play in front of what is expected to be the biggest home crowd in the history of this grand football tradition. It's your college football wake-up call as perennial BCS contending Kansas State, the Wildcats, make a rare trip east. They're looking to bounce back after their 11-year bowl streak ended in 2004. And today's theme for many in white and purple is not just about getting back, but about getting revenge. In 2003, the Wildcats were the number six team in the country. They were hosting Marshall, but Marshall never went away. They pulled ahead with just 3 minutes to play. The major upset, though, would come down to one last play. A fourth down pass to the end zone. It fell incomplete. Marshall pulled off the shocker 27-20. And here are the Wildcats. They want to erase that memory, and history's on their side. They are 41-3 in the last 14 years of September ball. Of course, Marshall, the biggest home game they've ever had. They are really jacked up with this early morning atmosphere here. Good morning. So glad you can be with us. Joe Tessitore alongside Ray Bentley, the start of what should be an outstanding day of college football. And we think we have a real good one here, Ray, because there are two emerging superstars for each school, positions that they're used to having superstars at. And for Marshall, that means we could be seeing the next great quarterback. They had Pennington, they had Leftwich. Now we have the first start of the gifted Bernie Morris.
And Bernie Morris has all the tools. He's an amazing athlete. He's what you would expect out of a Marshall quarterback, tremendous arm strength, much like Leftwich, but he's not the typical dropback guy. He can scoot. He's a threat to run with the football, and they'll use him that way. The only thing Bernie Morris doesn't really have is a lot of experience. Now, on the other side for Kansas State, they're known for their running backs. They're trying to replace Darren Sproles, who's gone on to the Chargers in the NFL. Well, they may have found the guy in Thomas Clayton. 177 yards last week, 10 yards per carry, busted an 80-yarder, and a key to this game is will Marshall be able to contain Thomas Clayton?
Yeah, that's a real big challenge for this front seven of Marshall today. Let's say hello to the third member of our broadcast team, Janine Edwards, details a tale of two Snyders.
Well, Joe, they share the same last name and love of college football, but that's where the similarities end. Bill Snyder of Kansas State is a 17-year veteran and National Coach of the Year three times. He's credited with the greatest turnaround in college football history, and Kansas State has been to 11 bowl games in the last 12 years. Mark Snyder, on the other hand, is in his first season as a head coach after spending 4 years as an assistant at Ohio State. He returns to his alma mater, Marshall, and steps into the shoes of retired coaching legend Bob Pruitt. And he's playing before a national television audience today, Joe. How's that for pressure?
Yeah, that's a lot of pressure, Janine. Nothing like a new head coach in a pressure situation. Just his second game ever. Comes against the biggest name opponent ever. And there is Bobby Pruitt, the legendary coach here in Huntington. Today, Bobby Pruitt Day, and the accomplishments just go on and on. For the old bowl coach, who had five MAC titles and a 1996 Division I AA national title, he said he knew when his time would come to retire, and that time was this past spring. So we will open up with Kansas State's Jeff Snodgrass kicking off, back to receive for the Thundering Herd. That's number 39, Dante Newsom, one of their starting linebackers. What a rarity to see a starting linebacker back to receive the kick. He is flanked by number 4, Chris Hawkins.
I can tell you, as an old linebacker, that's a dream to be able to return a kick.
Hawkins from the end zone, taken down at the 15-yard line, and that's where Marshall will start things off.
The
Last week, Marshall was able to send out Jimmy Skinner to be the starting quarterback, but this week, it's all in the hands of sophomore sensation Bernie Morris. He came off the bench, tossed three touchdowns against William & Mary. 6'4", an Orlando native. He has height, speed, and a very strong arm.
And they are extremely excited about his upside. Larry Keck, the offensive coordinator, was gushing when we talked to him.
Three wide receivers set. You'll see that all day long from the Thundering Herd. Bradshaw, running room to the right side, crosses the 20 for a 7-yard gain. Bradshaw, of course, is the lone back in the starting backfield. A real game breaker. Had a 52-yard swing pass last week for a touchdown. Number 22, Wilbur Hargrove, is the leader of the receivers. Morris and Moore is alongside. Offensive line, Cook, Baines, Ligurski, Ziegler, and 340-pound Toby Bullock. He has started 25 straight games.
Yeah, he's the anchor of that offensive line over there at the left tackle spot.
Second and three. Fake to Bradshaw. Here's Bernie Morris, and he will gladly do this all day long. Close to a first down, pickup of three on that, and indeed he has it. Ted Sims and Marcus Watts in on the tackle for the Wildcats. K-State's defense up front. George and Siler at the ends. Moran and Echols, real thick run stoppers in the middle. Maurice Mack, Ted Sims, Brandon Archer. They're a good group of linebackers. They can run. Some eye-openers among the DBs. Number 17, Maurice Porter. Number 2, Marcus Watson. Ray, the play of number 6, Garvin, and number 3, Baldwin on the edges. That grabbed your attention.
Yeah, two outstanding corners with tremendous speed, and they will be tested today as Marshall loves to throw the football.
So Bernie Morris picks up the first down. They go back to the run, and look at Bradshaw, what he does best, getting to the edge, and another first down. Good block by the tight end, Jeff Mullins, a pickup of 15.
And Mullins secured the corner on the right side, and that allowed Bradshaw to get over there. Right over here, watch the block by the tight end right there, blocking that point of attack on the corner, and Bradshaw gets the edge. And right now, Marshall, who we expected to be a passing team, has come out and run it for three straight plays and garnered two first downs.
So a good start to the day. There you see Jeff Mullins, a 6'3", 255-pound senior. Chubb Small is in now as the lone back. Out of the shotgun is Bernie Morris. And they'll give the ball to Small, and he has some running room out to the 47-yard line. Good pickup for the true freshman, Ryan Baines, the right guard, with a very nice tackle out in front. Very nice block out in front as the K-State defense back on their heels early a little bit.
And the Kansas State defense had struggled last year, and they thought they had put things back together a little bit in their opening win. But they were suspect early in that game last week against the run. Now, they shorted up as the game went on, but that is a problem spot for that K-State front.
A lot of formation movement for Marshall. They're well conditioned to that. This is Bradshaw out to midfield. It'll bring up a third down.
Ball came out late, but it was marked down. Fumble caused by the ground, so nothing there. But this Kansas State defense has been known throughout the years as being an outstanding defense. Look at these NCAA rankings, 4th, 3rd, 2nd, 6th. And then last year, they kind of fell off the charts a little bit. And that was a huge concern for Coach Bill Snyder, and that's a point of emphasis for that defense this year. And they did another thing to help change that. They moved their defensive coordinator down on the field.
Bob Elliott, defensive coordinator, his 4th season with the Wildcats. 4 receivers spread across now on 3rd down and 2 right at midfield for Bernie Morris. Morris, lots of time. Goes downfield, the open man complete to the 30-yard line. Hiram Moore, first down Marshall. 20-yard pickup.
Well, the key to this one is the great protection. And that's another deficiency for that Kansas State defense, their ability to get after the quarterback. They did not bring a lot of heat last week. And right there, they gave Morris a ton of time to throw the football. You see the pass rush now. They're really bringing 4, and they're kind of playing a spy deal. They're really not coming after him. And when you give a talented guy like Morris that kind of time, someone will get open. And it was Hiram Moore who got himself open on that one.
Could be the coming out party for Bernie Morris today. Well hyped, well talked about sophomore from Orlando. Bradshaw, the inside carry, a pickup of 3. Maurice Mack on the tackle. Bernie Morris, last week, 3 touchdowns against William and Mary. He was recruited to play at Central Florida, but not as a quarterback. And, Ray, he's one of those kids that was his mindset. I'm going to be the leading quarterback.
Well, he was actually a wide receiver here as a freshman. They tried him there, but he stuck to his guns as far as wanting to be a quarterback. And they gave him that opportunity. And, boy, has he opened some eyes.
Moving the ball well here. Marshall is crossed into inside the 30-yard line, that comfort field goal zone. Morris now sprinting to his right, keeps it himself, and gets down to the 23-yard line before Ted Sims cuts him down.
That's just a little lead option by the quarterback over the right side, and that's something that's a new wrinkle for the Marshall offense, and they're able to do that because of the athleticism of Morris. And the other thing that does, if you run a little bit of option, the defense has to prepare to stop the option. And that's just another thing you have to worry about. And when we see Kansas State, they will also run the option with their quarterback. So it's just another thing thrown on the plate of a defensive coordinator.
5 DBs in the game now on 3rd down and 3. K-State defense looking for a little bend but don't break here early on against Marshall. Here's Morris back to pass. Pressure this time. Stays on his feet and now wrapped up. Maurice Mack comes up with the tackle. Pressured him there. And it'll bring up a 4th down for the Thundering Herd.
Well, Kansas State couldn't get there with just bringing 4. So watch, they're going to blitz the linebacker. Here's Mack right here and Archer right there. And they're going to bring the linebackers. Actually, it's Mack who ends up coming. You see him get picked up late, but he fights off the block, stays in the play, and comes up with a sack.
So a 43-yard field goal attempt now for Ian O'Connor. And O'Connor is able to put it up and through. A nice opening drive for Bernie Morris and the Thundering Herd offense. They are up 3-0, 9:42 to go in the first. Let's see if K-State can get something on the board when we come back. Head coach Bill Snyder for the Kansas State Wildcats, his 17th season. Remember, he took over this program. They were on a stretch, a winless stretch of 0-26-1, but boy, has he turned things around. But now he has to do it again. Last year, the first time in 11 years that the Wildcats didn't make a bowl game, and now they find themselves trailing Marshall 3-0 early on here in Huntington.
Yeah, one of the things he talked about was the spirit of the football team and the enthusiasm, and he addressed those issues in the offseason.
Ian O'Connor, after his 44-yard field goal, kicking off, sends it to the end zone. This is Yaman Figures, very speedy return man, but nothing doing. The ball is loose. It's on the ground, and Marshall looks to have recovered down at the 11-yard line.
You know, Figures is the guy that fumbled a punt return last week, and they took him out and had Marrera return punts after that. Now he loses the football, and it's Marshall ball.
Jeremy Rodimer with the fumble recovery, great special teams play. And Coach Snyder, you know, Ray, he said all week long, we got to take care of that football. 2 for 2 now, fumbling the ball on returns for Figures.
Yeah, this is just not good. And he's doesn't have the football secured. And then the big hit coming in and putting the helmet right on the football came from C.J. Spillman of Marshall. He's the one who knocked that thing out of there.
So the Marshall offense with a chance here to jump out in front against K-State 2 years ago. They pulled off the major upset against the team that was number 6 in the country. And now, momentum building early. 4 wide receivers for Bernie Morris. Morris looking for the screen pass to Bradshaw. He's got his blocks, and he's down to the 6-yard line. A pickup of 5 yards.
You know, this is what they call a sudden change situation for the Kansas State defense. And they struggled in sudden change last year. And last week, they gave up the ball on turnovers a couple of times and allowed touchdowns 2 out of the 4 times after a sudden change. So the key right now is holding them to a field goal. That's what Kansas State has to hang their hat on.
They can make a 1st down at the 1-yard line, so this is a 2nd down and 5 from the 6. Once again, 3 receivers spread. Bradshaw gets the call. Good blocks up the middle, and he's into the end zone for a touchdown. Ahmad Bradshaw.
Boy, this is a role reversal of what I expected in this game. I thought Kansas State would come out and be able to punish with the run, but so far Marshall has had all the success on the ground with that man right there, Ahmad Bradshaw. And he is an outstanding back, built low to the ground. He's 5'9", but he's got unbelievable feet. And he showed you right there, gets it in the end zone.
What a start to the day for the Thundering Herd offense. The sophomore from Bluefield, Virginia, Bradshaw, punches it in. And now Ian O'Connor looking to tag on the extra point. He does so. A 10-zip lead, 8:51 left in the first, and the K-State offense hasn't gotten on the field.
And we talked to Larry Keck, the offensive coordinator. He said we need more continuity on the offensive line. Well, this is continuity right here. A nice block there by the backside guard 72, Ryan Baines, of cutting off that pursuit. And that gave just enough of a crack for Bradshaw to squeeze up in there and fight his way into the end zone.
Bradshaw had two touchdowns last week. We told you, Coach Larry Keck, the offensive coordinator, says, hey, this is a guy that you get a sense he just loves every aspect of football, loves to practice, loves to play, and you know he loves what just happened. Well, we told you, it's Coach Bobby Pruitt Day here. He had Randy Moss once upon a time, and he had plenty of wins here in Huntington. Won 94 games during his tenure, including 5 MAC titles. He led the Thundering Herd to 7 bowl appearances and placed 13 players into the NFL draft. Great memories for the Thundering Herd fans, and they're looking to make some new ones here today against a BCS league team, a very rare occurrence that a perennial power like Kansas State comes to Huntington. There's only been one other time that a BCS conference team has played here, and that was Temple. This is a much different beast.
And there's a lot of time left. Kansas State needs to just settle in and start playing their brand of football.
And guess who won't be returning the kick? Yamont Figures has been pulled in favor of Jermaine Morera. Here's Morera. Jermaine crosses the 20. He's got running room. Makes a move at the 37 and is finally pushed out of bounds at the 42-yard line. Good return for Morera. 43 yards on the kickoff return. So the Kansas State offense finally gets to come out onto the field. 8 minutes and 42 seconds left to go in the first, and we get our first glimpse of the quarterback, Alan Webb. He's 6'3". He's from Denver, Colorado. In fact, his grandfather, Wellington Webb, was once the mayor in Denver. And Webb did a real good job of just managing the offense, and they look for him to do the same here today.
Yeah, Webb has a very strong arm and is extremely accurate in the three-step game.
Play action, Webb, lots of time, and he's going downfield. Wide open is, unbelievable. Is that painful or what?
It's all set, the running back who he faked to initially on the bootleg, and he just snuck up the sidelines, and nobody from Marshall saw him. And that was an opportunity for Kansas State to get right back in the game, but Alsap ends up dropping this football.
Carlos Alsop is a guy who's just not on the field much. They sneak him out there for the first play. And, oh, boy, is he going to think about that one for a long time, Ray.
They brought him out. That was his chance to shine. And he was right there in the sun and dropped it.
Inside handoff now to Thomas Clayton. We told you about Clayton earlier. He's a very speedy tailback. Curtis Keyes came up with the tackle there. You see the big blockers, number 42, Victor Mann, the receivers, Figures, and Nelson. Nelson made the switch from defensive back. The line up front, Clary, Hafferty, Vogelai, Boss, and Wyford. So a third down early on here for Kansas State. Three receivers to the near side. Davin Dennis has come into the game, and now Webb chooses to go under center and audible here.
Yeah, you're going to see a lot of this throughout the game as both these teams like to change the call at the line of scrimmage and use as much time as possible.
They use too much.
Yeah. You're right.
Use too much, my friend.
But that's
that play
a good,
clock was ticking down.
That's a good decision by Alan Webb to take that timeout right there. It's a big third down early in the game.
Saw those great scenes with Coach Bobby Pruitt, all the success here in Marshall. He now joins our Janine Edwards. Janine.
That's right, Joe. He retired as Marshall's all-time winningest coach with 5 MAC championships. And 2 days before spring practice this season, you announced your retirement. Why'd you leave coaching?
It was just time. It was time to go in a little different direction for a little while. But it was all good. We had everything in place. And as you can see, we have a good football team.
Now, Mark Snyder is playing a formidable opponent today. He's playing before a national television audience and gallantly attempting to fill your shoes. If you were him, what would be going through your mind today?
Just doing what he's doing. He's got good players, and they're an outstanding coaching staff, and I'm so proud of what they're doing, I can't stand it. I'm really proud of what our student body alumni has done. We've raised over $500,000 for Katrina and hope to go to $1 million and give a buck campaign we started.
Wow, that's very noble.
Yeah.
Now, you lobbied hard to get Marshall into Conference USA. What will that mean for this program?
Well, it's recognition and perception. I think that we're very competitive, even though I think that the Mid-American Conference and some of their teams are very tough this year.
After 9 seasons as a head coach, what are you most proud of?
This right here, playing Kansas State at home.
Thanks, Coach. Joe?
And that's something. Won more games than any coach in Marshall history. And now, his former defense could come up with a big stop here. Swing pass to Clayton. Needs that first down, and he's got it.
The pass is completed.
Boy, and linebacker Dennis Thornton was out there, avoided the blocker, and had the chance to make the stop. But I'll tell you right now, Clayton is just too shifty. You're going to see the linebacker right here. That's Dennis Thornton right there, and he had the chance, but it cut back on him. Nice move there by Clayton. He is tough to bring down in open field, but that's a missed opportunity for this herd defense.
Now out of the shotgun, flanked by Clayton and man is Allen Webb. First down for K-State. The design quarterback run gets a nice block from Victor Mann, picks up a few yards. 5-yard pickup. You can see what a good blocker man can be when he's out there in front. Marshall defense, let's take a look at them. They have to replace the All-American Jonathan Goddard and 6 other starters from last year up front. Greer, Underwood, Davis, and Thomas are on the line. Matt Couch is in the middle. Dennis Thornton, we saw him with that missed tackle, and Dante Newsome, who was back on kickoffs outside. Willie Smith and North Carolina transfer Chris Hawkins are the corners, number 25 Keys, number 26 Royal. Very hard-hitting safeties.
And Keys is the guy who will come down in the box and be that 8th man in the box. And Royal forced a couple of turnovers last week. Very active safeties.
Webb out of the shotgun again. Another designed run. Quarterback draw this time. And he's just short of a first down. But you can see the athleticism and all the options that Allen Webb gives you.
Yeah, it's just another thing that you have to worry about as a defense. We'll take a look. The pass protection is okay, but this is quarterback draw. I think he's just waiting, setting it up, and now he's just coming with the football and finding any kind of space or running to daylight out of that position, and they love to use Webb in that situation. They have a lot of designed runs for him, both out of the shotgun and under center.
Two receivers leave, and they're going with a double tight end formation. Jordy Nelson flanked out. On 3rd down and 1, Clayton is the tailback in that I formation. Here he is. 1st down and more. Thomas Clayton, can he turn on that speed once again? Yes, into the end zone. Thomas Clayton, the transfer from Florida State, who exploded last week for 177 yards and 2 touchdowns, grabs his first of the day today. Good blocking up front from Vogeli and Boss.
You know, and you see it so often on short yardage plays where if they bust through the line of scrimmage, it's going to go to the house. And that's exactly what happened here. Marshall stacked up against the run, tried to come in and fill all the gaps, did not get that A-gap covered. And once Clayton busted through, it was a foot race to the house, and you saw Clayton won that one.
So K-State answers right back. What an offensive start to the day. Snodgrass on for the extra point. It is up and it is good. So the Wildcats answer the bell. Thomas Clayton, the junior from Virginia, the 38-yard touchdown run. 10-6, Marshall, 5:46 to go in the first. We'll be right back.
ESPN2's College Football, brought to you by Jeep. Trail-rated capability, only in a Jeep 4x4. And smooth Busch beer and easy drinking Busch Light.
There's the memorial fountain here on the campus of Marshall, of course, honoring the 75 who died in the tragic plane crash of 1970. 75 points on top of that fountain. Just some of the symbols of remembrance here in town. There's 75 flags that fly along 3rd Avenue. The worst sports-related air disaster our country has ever seen when Marshall lost its football team back in 1970. 10-7, Marshall on top. K-State bounced back moments ago. This is Chris Hawkins on the return. And Hawkins able to get out to the 18-yard line. 13-yard return. Greg Gaskins with the tackle. Ray, moments ago, Thomas Clayton, the explosive speed.
Yeah, well, you're going to see a stunt right here. This defensive lineman is going to crash inside, and they run right behind that. See the stunt that he ran in, and then the cutback by Clayton. He saw that thing get washed down, and all he needed was a little bit of a seam, and then he popped it through, and it was Katie Bar the door running to the house.
Last week, he had an 80-yard touchdown run. A play in which he was sandwiched in the backfield and then burst through with all that blazing speed to go for 80 yards. And a 38-yarder moments ago, 10-7 Marshall. Bradshaw going to test that right side. Tyarris George came up with the tackle after a 3-yard pickup.
I think George is a pretty solid guy both in the run and the pass, but the two guys up front that they really use to stop the run are 56 Quentin Echols and 50 Junior Moran, and those guys are pretty good stopping the run. See a lot of shifting by that Marshall offense.
Now in the shotgun without a running back is Morris. Morris is going to keep it himself, design play. And he's wrapped up just a pickup of maybe a yard, but Maurice Mack was able to come in once again. He had 5 tackles last week against Florida International.
You know, more on that shifting by the Marshall offense. We talked to Larry Keck, the offensive coordinator, and I said, well, what's the main point that you get out of all that shifting? He said, you know, the biggest thing is it just makes the defense have to prepare for that many more things. They've got to determine, all right, where do they start, where do they end up, and it does put a lot on that defensive coordinator. A
little brain clogger there.
Yes.
A little mind bender for him. Third down and 6 now.
Try to create that confusion.
Morris, the 6'4 sophomore, had a great opening drive, and now faces a third down against the K-State defense. Incomplete. It was intended for Hargrove. A little high. Marcus Watts came in and pressured on the blitz, but yeah, for the first time, we will see Marshall punt.
That was just a drop, though. Hargrove's got to make that catch, and he knows that. And one of the things I'll tell you about Bernie Morris, he throws a heater. That ball comes out hot when he throws it, and it makes it a little tough on the receivers. They really have to concentrate.
Now, that was the wrap on him. Some questions his consistency in his hands. Costly there on third down. Marty Biagi with the punt. Not the best looking thing you've ever seen. Falls a little short, but takes a fortuitous bounce for the Thundering Herd all the way inside the 30 to the 27-yard line. So Bernie Morris not able to get it done that time. Now K-State's back on offense. We'll see if Thomas Clayton has something up his sleeve. Thomas Clayton fans here in Huntington, West Virginia. They liked what they saw the last time the K-State offense had the ball, as Clayton was able to explode for a 38-yard touchdown. Of course, the man he's replacing, Darren Sproles. Was he something special or what in the purple and silver? 11th in NCAA history with 49-79, almost 5,000 career yards rushing. He had 3 consecutive 1,000 rushing yard seasons. Of course, now he's part of the San Diego Chargers backfield. And there's Thomas Clayton. He's doing a nice job of filling in those big shoes.
Yeah, he's looking very sprolish.
Very sprolish. Clayton goes 6 foot, 225 pounds, so he's a bigger tailback, but you can see the speed is there, and here he goes again. Janine Edwards has more on Thomas Clayton. Janine?
Well, Joe, he may look sprawlish, but he says he would love to play like Edgerrin James of the Colts. Tough, powerful, great vision. Clayton says he's determined to be the best back in the nation, and he was popular right out of high school, recruited by Florida State, North Carolina, Penn State, and Notre Dame.
Now, he was one of the high school Americans who Florida State was able to rope into a recruiting class, but he transferred to K-State, had to sit out 2003, but a young man in the offseason was clocked in the 40-yard dash running a 4.32. Now the option to the right side. Webb. Close to the 35-yard line. Tackled by number 95, Chris Terrell.
There's that option wrinkle from Kansas State. Both of them will do it because they have the athleticism at quarterback. And again, that just puts a little more pressure on the defense.
So it'll bring up a third down. Thundering Herd faithful. Big day for them. Third down and two.
Big play action down for Kansas State.
And the Thunder claps are out as this Edwards Stadium generating some good noise early on here in the first quarter.
Oh,
penalty marker
one.
Comes down. They did indeed. It's going to be a first down for the Wildcats.
Looked like Adrian Davis was the man that was offside.
Davis, the junior from Quebec, and strangely enough, Coach Collins.
Prior to the snap, offsides. Number 84 made contact prior to the snap. 5-yard penalty results in a first down.
Defensive coordinator Jim Collins calls Davis the smartest player on the defensive line. Not that time. Of course, a big day of college football right here on ESPN. Steve Spurrier, yeah, welcome back to the SEC. How about playing number 9 Georgia at 5:30 with DJ Shockley coming off those 5 touchdowns? Then tonight, you know, because of Hurricane Katrina, the LSU-Arizona State game moved out to Tempe, number 5 versus number 15 at 9 p.m. First down for Webb and company. Three receivers in for the Wildcats. Clayton one more time. Good hole on the left side. And Clayton still pushing forward close to midfield. A pickup of nearly 10 yards. Going to be close to that marker. Victor Mann with another good block from that fullback position.
Yeah, what they're doing, Kansas State right now, is spreading things out with three wide receivers. That puts Marshall in their nickel package, so they've only got 6 in the box. And Kansas State likes that. They feel that they can run against just 6 in the box, and they're proving so far that they can.
So it'll be second and very short here. Thomas Clayton off to a great start today. 4 carries, 54 yards, and a touchdown. Offensive coordinator's dream second and short, because you can do this. Go downfield, and it's complete. Good pickup. Jermaine Morera. 7 receptions last week, an 18-yarder hauled in. Coverage from Willie Smith.
I think Morera is their best receiver. He's a special guy. He has the great hands, but he runs superb routes, and he's able to shake his man one-on-one. Here's the play action. You can see Webb make the fake. And then watch this outcut. You see Morera up there on the top left-hand side of your screen, gets the separation, and then, boy, he's a threat running after the catch as well. He's got everything in his toolbox.
Junior from Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, had a 67-yard punt return last week also. So first down for K-State out of the shotgun now is Webb. Option to the left side. And Webb picks up close to 10 yards. Curtis Keyes came up from that strong safety position, finally cut him down, but about a 9.5-yard gain for the junior quarterback, Allen Webb.
And you get a sense now that Kansas State has awoken. You know, an early game for them. You know, it's just 9:30 actually at kickoff back in Kansas. And so they kind of came out stumbling a little bit, but now you get the feeling that they're back in control.
Another second and short. Lots of options for Webb, and he's going to Jordy Nelson. Touchdown, Kansas State. Penalty marker is down. We're going to need to check that. But Allen Webb took full advantage of the down and distance once again and sent it flying to the corner of the end zone.
Yeah, nice play call over there. They ran that play action pass on second and less than one, and it turned out well.
Holding. Number 55 on the defense. That penalty is declined. Touchdown.
Well, breakfast in Huntington, not just eggs and bacon, but we're serving up a whole lot of offense here. Jordy Nelson. He was a defensive back a year ago. He made the switch. Second fastest wide receiver on the team. And a big target at 6'3". Balls in the touchdown pass there, his second of the season. Snodgrass with the extra point. The big leg pumps it through. And K-State, just like that, up in front.
Jordy Nelson is an imposing wide receiver. You see the play action and watch to the right of your screen. Nelson's going to be streaking across right there. Perfectly thrown ball from Webb over the top. And we'll take a look at Jordy Nelson. You see the defender right there, Willie Smith, got his eyes caught into the backfield. And then Royal, the safety, comes over to help as well, but it's just too late. Those defenders, they got caught in a run situation with their eyes in the backfield at the quarterback. And when you do that, you give that receiver the step, and it's over.
Coach Mark Snyder, you see him there on the Thundering Herd sidelines. And there's Chris Royal. We got beat on that play. The senior was tied for second in the nation last year with 6 interceptions. There's a guy who had a lot of interceptions back in the day. Coach Mark Snyder had 10 when he was a defensive back in one season here at Marshall.
1987. They had a 10-5 record. Were national runner-ups in 1AA football.
Pretty much could pick a year in the late 80s or early 90s and say they were either national runner-ups or national champions. What a tremendous 1AA program they had here at Marshall. Of course, all the success in 1A since moving up in 97. Chris Hawkins fumbling and bumbling with the ball at the 5, then catches a seam and plenty of green in front of him. Chris Hawkins fumbles the ball. A pile up at the 45 for it. Justin McKinney forced the fumble for K-State after a 42-yard return, but it's going to be real interesting to see who's got it, and the Wildcats do.
Well, what a hustle play by McKinney, because he is one of those gunners. He ran down, was one of the first guys down, saw the thing break past him, and got on his horse and tracked it down, and then had the presence of mind to rip the football out when he came and tried to make the tackle.
Sorrell Davis came in on the recovery, but here's the return, which was an outstanding return by Hawkins right up until the end when Justin McKinney popped it out on that tackle.
Yeah, that's just a heads-up play. McKinney, well-coached, understanding, and he's coming from behind. Hawkins could not see him, so what do you do? Go for the football, rip it out, and that's exactly what he did.
So what a turnaround here as we come to the end of the first quarter. This will be the last play of the first quarter for Allen Webb and the K-State offense. Thomas Clayton, nothing there. Really nice defensive surge by Albert McClellan. A 2-yard loss. The freshman from Lakeland, Florida, coming in and doing what not many defenders have done. Stop Thomas Clayton. Closes out an action-packed first quarter here from Huntington. Marshall was hyped up. The biggest crowd, the biggest opponent that's ever been here. And they started out hot. Ahmad Bradshaw, they were up 10-0. But the Wildcats would wake up on this early morning. Thomas Clayton, the 38-yard touchdown, and K-State's up 14-10. ESPN2 College Football. Beautiful Saturday morning in Huntington, West Virginia. Breakfast in Huntington. We've served up plenty of offense as we start the second quarter here. Wildcats with a 14-10 lead and a second down and 11 for Allen Webb out of the shotgun. Inside handoff this time back to the original line of scrimmage is the big fullback, Victor Mann. Curtis Keyes came up with the tackle.
Yeah, Keyes came up from the secondary late. It'd be that eighth man in the box, and then he blitzed. You're going to see Keyes. He's going to be right here Over on this side, he comes up late, has that safety, and then watch him just shoot this gap when he sees it coming and gets a tackle for a loss right there. And that's just a heck of a job of Keys and his timing on that blitz and his recognition of the run.
So a third and long here for Allen Webb. Three wide receivers, two to the near, one to the top. Webb trying to set up the screen to Thomas Clayton. He's so dangerous in the open field, and he's got a first down to the 42-yard line, a 13-yard pickup. The cornerback, Willie Smith, finally was able to take out the legs of the speedy Thomas Clayton.
This is just a great job of setting up the screen. You're going to see the offensive lineman kind of push guys by and then come out and get in front. And right there, it wasn't much of a block by big number 72 Hafferty, but he did force the defender to pick a side. And if you pick a side and Clayton's got the ball, he's going to pick the other side and he's going to get some good yards.
Yeah, very shifty, has that instant acceleration. So K-State moving the ball again. Clayton, inside handoff, nice move to get to the 36-yard line. Pickup of 6 yards. Keys once again coming up.
And I said it earlier towards the end of that first quarter, Kansas State now has gotten their offense settled down into a rhythm, and they are doing whatever they want right now. That Marshall defense, which came out very good early on, they're starting to leak a little bit. They're leaking some oil.
It was 2 years ago when Marshall went to Manhattan, Kansas, and upset the sixth-ranked team in the country 27-20. You know that's still on the minds of this Wildcat program. Clayton, close to another first down, probably just short. Curtis Keys once again in on the tackle. The junior from Mississippi has been very active so far today.
You know, I talked about having six in the box. One, two, three, four, five, six is what Marshall has in the box. Because of the spread out formation, they've got to commit defensive backs all over the field here to take that away. And now you have a better matchup on the inside in the running game. And that's what they're doing right now. When they see six in the box, they're checking to the run and they're being successful with it.
Advantageous matchup for Thomas Clayton. Clayton will be the lone back. Three wide receivers, nickel package, and a first down with a 2-yard pickup by Webb.
Yeah, well-coached football team right there. You come up, you just have a little bit to go, so you go ahead, quick count, quarterback sneak, catch that defense not quite ready, and you only have to get a little bit. And when Webb's got the football in there, he's got some pretty strong, powerful legs at 6'3", 210 pounds. He'll get you those 6 inches.
Ray, it's so interesting to see the differences from week one to week two with football teams. In college football, they say that's the biggest learning gap you'll ever see. But if there's one thing you can say about both teams, the intensity and the focus really rises up in that week two.
It really does, and I think Kansas State recaptured that. Marshall came out on fire, and then Kansas State kind of rebounded off of that. Now they've taken the momentum.
Webb now going to air it out, looking for figures. Incomplete. Coverage by Willie Smith. He stayed with him stride for stride.
Yeah, very good, solid coverage by Willie Smith, the senior out of Palm Beach Garden, Florida. Locked right up on figures and was with him the whole way. Here's the look at it. You see the good technique, gets the hand on him, the turn and run, and now when the receiver looks for the ball, defender turns and looks for the ball. Just great end to that play by Willie Smith.
6 foot senior Willie Smith. Defensive coordinator Jim Collins made the point of saying, you know, he's 6 foot tall, but he's got longer arms than a man of that size, and that helps him out a lot out there on the edge. So a second down out of the shotgun again for K-State from the 31-yard line. Webb's going to keep it himself. Webb is taken down. Matt Couch, the middle linebacker, takes him down after a 5-yard pickup. It'll bring up a third down.
Yeah, good open field tackle by Matt Couch, who, and we were speaking to Jim Collins, the defensive coordinator of Marshall, and he pointed him out as a guy that needs to step up into a leadership role. He said Curtis Keys and Chris Royal are kind of the leaders, but they're looking for Matt Couch to step up and take his part of that.
So a third down and 5 for K-State. You can see they're 4 for 4 thus far in converting third downs. Let's see if they can do it again with three wide receivers to the top of the screen. They're going to swing it out to Clayton. Always a good option, especially when he does this. Second touchdown of the day for Thomas Clayton. Picked up a good block from his tight end, Rashad Norwood.
Boy, and Del Miller, the offensive coordinator for Kansas State, is calling a heck of a game right now. Caught him in a blitz. And when you're blitzing against the screen pass, if the man who's covering that fullback, which that time was Dennis Thornton, doesn't get over there, you're going to be in trouble. And that's exactly what it was, is Marshall had nobody available to come pursue that screen pass.
Thomas Clayton, as advertised, Ray, we talked so much about what he offers up in replacing Darren Sproles, transferred over from Florida State, just full of speed and electricity. And he's come through today. Snodgrass tacks it on, and that K-State offense is rolling. Thomas Clayton, second touchdown of the day. Great acceleration. Marshall have the ball when we come back to Huntington. Stay with us. Joe Tessitore, Ray Bentley, Janine Edwards with you here in Huntington, West Virginia. K-State has jumped out 21-10. Ray, they trail 10-0, but the big plays got them back into this.
Yeah, and the big player, and that's Thomas Clayton right there. He pops a third and short, gets through the line, and then just takes it to the house, and they come back to some play action on a second and short, and the defenders kind of peek with their eyes, and Jordy Nelson gets that touchdown reception, and then it's back to Clayton. Another outstanding call by the Kansas State coaching staff, a screen pass, caught him in a blitz, and it, you know, won't get much easier than that for Thomas Clayton, just a jaunt into the end zone. And look at those total yards, Kansas State just dominating.
Allen Webb, you saw moments ago, walking over the sidelines, calm, cool, and collected, and Thomas Clayton, not even breathing hard, just another day at the office for the junior from Alexandria, Virginia. He is off to a sensational start to this college football season, replacing Darren Sproles, the all-everything tailback, who exploded for three straight 1,000-yard seasons during his Wildcat career. Marshall looking to answer. Chris Hawkins back the last time he had the ball in a return. He fumbled it. Hawkins hesitates and then doesn't reach the 20-yard line. To the 19-yard line, John McCardle able to come up with the stop. Flag is down.
Offside on the kicking team.
Well, K-State has really come together, and team unity a theme, Janine Edwards, isn't it?
That's right, Joe. You know, after the debacle that was their 4-7 season last year, Coach Bill Snyder said, "I came to a conclusion at the end of the season that we had some guys that were playing as individuals and not as a team." So he decided to take the names off of the Kansas State jerseys. That's the first time this team has played without names on their back since 1987. And Snyder gave two examples of Kansas State teams that overachieved without big name players, 99 and 02.
And that team unity paying off here in the second quarter against Marshall. Hey, whatever it takes after a season that they're not used to having. Some were questioning, is that the way it's going, or was it just a hiccup? Complete over the middle, crosses the 30-yard line for a 6-yard pickup. Matt Morris on the reception from Bernie Morris. Morris to Morris.
You know, just to follow up on Janine's story there, you know, it's more important the name on the front of the jersey than the back of the jersey. You're playing as a team. Football is the greatest team sport there is, and I think that's a very insightful move by Coach Snyder to go ahead and take those names off and point the emphasis on team.
Second down. Morris complete. First down for Marshall, Sean Lazon. Early morning here in Huntington. Breakfast in Huntington to serve up your college football day. Going to be a spectacular day of college football, and we're so glad that you can join us here. 21-10, K-State on top. I'm Joe Tessitore alongside Ray Bentley and Janine Edwards. Well, rushing the ball, Marshall started off good. Bradshaw had the touchdown, but look at the numbers from Thomas Clayton. Two touchdowns, 62 yards. K-State up by 11. Incomplete on first down. Bernie Morris, the quarterback from Orlando, his first start. You see him there, 6'4". They say he has all the gifts because, you know, the great quarterbacks that came out of Marshall here, Pennington was cerebral. Leftwich wasn't necessarily a guy who was fleet-footed, but Morris has all the tools.
Yeah, they say that he's got the best of both of those guys thrown into one because he's got the great feet, he's got the size, and he's got a rocket for an arm as well.
Out of the shotgun now, a designed quarterback run, but it's really tough to get to that edge with all the pursuit. Tierris George, a two-yard loss. Nice play by George coming across from that defensive end position. Good pursuit by K-State.
All right, and Marshall has put Wesley Jones in at that right tackle spot. He's spelling Seth Cook, and that's right where they tried to run the football. And Tierris George was having none of it. Kept his discipline, kept the outside hand free, skated down the line, and made a heck of a play.
So a third down and 12. Bernie Morris, first career start, now facing the challenges of a Big 12 defense who's hungry and has the lead. Morris, lots of time this time. Downfield for Lazon, well covered on the play, slightly overthrown, and it goes incomplete. You can see Morris is incredulous to the fact that a flag wasn't thrown, but Kyle Williams and Justin McKinney with good coverage.
Morris ran 30 yards down the field to try and make his case on that deal, but I don't think he had a very strong case. You're going to see the end of the play right here, and you see Williams just make an incidental bump as he's reaching for the football, and that thing was overthrown anyway. Boy, Morris is trying to show you he can officiate as well as play.
So Marty Biaggi steps on to punt for Marshall. Gets off a good high spiraling kick. Marrera waiting for it at the 20 and instantly wrapped up and brought all the way down at the 11-yard line. Very nice coverage on special teams by Chris Hawkins. So K-State will get the ball back. Let's see if they can add more to their 21-10 lead.
ESPN2's College Football, brought to you by Cargill. We collaborate, create, and succeed with our customers. And KFC's new flavor station. Be the boss. Choose your sauce at KFC.
Home crowd looking for a little defense here. K-State up 21-10 on Marshall here in the second quarter. Thomas Clayton. 3-yard pickup. Just the start to a big day of college football. Of course, ABC will have regional coverage today at 3:30. Then tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern. Boy, is this a big one early in the season. First ever meeting between Texas and Ohio State. Number 2 visits the horseshoe. Number 4, Ohio State. Can they stop the Heisman candidate Vince Young? I'll tell you what, this is a couch potato night tonight,
yes,
Ray Bentley.
Can't wait to get home and do that, exactly that.
Play action, Allen Webb. Look at the time he has. Airs it out downfield. And Jordy Nelson, the former defensive back, turned into a defensive back for K-State that time. Batting it away, Jeremy Rodimer thought he was going to come up with an interception.
Yeah, and Webb got very lucky there because he did not see Rodimer sitting on that backside. And he just kind of lofted that one up. And Nelson broke it up, or that was a definite interception. See, here's a little play action. Ducks down, but Webb does not see the corner coming over here from this other side. Right there, jumping in front. Rodimer should have had that interception. He's got to come to the football. If he comes to the football, he's got an interception.
Nickel packaging for the Marshall defense, trying to stop K-State on a third down. They haven't today. K-State's 5 for 5. Screen pass, Jordy Nelson. Close to a first down. I think he got it. 6 for 6. Curtis Keyes came up with the stop. Nice play by Jordy Nelson. Very fast and big target. 6'3" and the second fastest player on the team.
And a nice scheme by the Wildcats. They've been very successful with the screen to Clayton. So they set that up. They show the screen to Clayton to the left, and it was actually a double screen. They run the receiver screen back to the right, and that's a pretty good play call. I like this scheme. I like the way this offense is being called right now. Del Miller, the offensive coordinator, doing an outstanding job.
I'll tell you, we talk so much about Bernie Morris, the quarterback for Marshall, and all his upside, but Allen Webb is putting together a great first half here for Kansas State. We got movement up front. Looked like there's motion on K-State right side of the line, Ray.
It's Wofford to the right tackle.
Hear what?
Defense was moving as well. We'll see who they call it on.
Bill Gelbke will clear things up.
Offsides. Defense number 52 make contact. 5 yards, remains first down.
Well, that's one of those that's a little questionable, too, because Wofford definitely moved early, but they're going to say that he was drawn off by the defense. And that was Floyd Wright, number 52, who got that penalty.
Floyd Wright got a late start to football, was a two-time All-American high school wrestler, and was a junior college All-American wrestler, and now in the rotation of that front seven for the Thundering Herd.
Right, at Moore Park College.
Remember, they're trying to replace Jonathan Goddard, the all-everything defensive lineman from a year ago. This one intercepted. Jeremy Rodimer, and a good return to boot. Rodimer inside the 10 and finally hauled down. Big left tackle Jeremy Cleary finally wrapped him up, but not before a 45-yard return by Jeremy Rodimer.
And Allen Webb was not on the same page as his receivers. All three receivers on that right side ran vertical. They ran go routes. He expected somebody to break that route off. He threw underneath, and there's just the defenders there. You're going to see, look at those receivers up on the right side. Everybody going deep. He expected somebody, and it looked like Jordy Nelson, to kind of hook up into that seam area. The receiver did not do that. Webb threw it to the spot, and Rodimer was right there.
First career interception for Jeremy Rodimer, who comes from enemy territory in Morgantown, West Virginia. They're going to start playing the Mountaineers come next year as Marshall. Bernie Morris now. Inside handoff to Ahmad Bradshaw. Nothing doing, no gain. It'll bring up second down and goal. Steve Birch with a nice tackle.
A good penetration from Birch down there. Shot the inside gap. Blocker did not get to him. And he hit Bradshaw in the backfield. This is another one of those sudden change opportunities for the Kansas State defense.
See Rodimer there celebrating his first career interception and putting his offense in great shape here. They're knocking on the door. Can they bust it down? Try to stop this flow of Kansas State. They've scored three unanswered touchdowns. Empty backfield for Bernie Morris. He's keeping it himself. Crowded in the middle, isn't it? Lost 4 yards. The entire front four of K-State meeting at the quarterback.
Well, they knew that Marshall loves the quarterback draw down in that area of the field. In fact, last week Marshall ran that play as a two-point play in their win over William and Mary. So the scouting was they did a nice job of scouting this one out, and nobody was fooled by that quarterback draw.
Little group photo there. So a third down and goal. Can Marshall take advantage of the opportunity that their defense has given them?
Great spot for a screen pass to Bradshaw.
He's very dangerous if he can get himself out to the outside. Third and goal. Morris looked to Bradshaw first. Now lots of time. Goes over the middle to Hiram Moore. And it's a pickup of 5 yards. And they're giving him a look here on fourth down. What will Mark Snyder do?
I think you have to kick. You have to kick and get the points right now. I mean, it'd be different if you're down on the 1 yard line, say, and you got a chance to just power it in. But fourth and four from the four, this early in a ball game, get your points right now. Make it a one possession game.
I completely agree. I mean, 5:20 and counting here in the second quarter. Long day of football still ahead of us. Ian O'Connor will trot on. He made a 44 yarder earlier today. This attempt, easy doings from 21. So K-State, three unanswered touchdowns until that. The interception sets up the field goal, 21-13 Wildcats. How many times do you see a four-play, one-yard drive that results in a score? We just saw it, and Marshall now cuts the lead to 21-13. That guy right there hopes he's going to be a future NFL star, does Bernie Morris. Of course, Marshall has seen their fair share. Randy Moss was here for 2 years, put up huge numbers, and ended up in New York as a Heisman Trophy finalist. Of course, the starting quarterback of the New York Jets, 115 touchdowns during his Thundering Herd career. And then Byron Leftwich came to town, was a 3-year starter. And of course, that courage, most memorable scene here at Marshall, Leftwich being helped down the field when he had the bum leg. All three of them ended up being Heisman Trophy top six finishers. And there is Bernie Morris, quarterback from Orlando. is off to a great start here against K-State. Marshall jumped out 10-0. And then Kansas State, with all that speed and talent, led by Thomas Clayton, the star tailback. Three touchdowns to make it 21-10. Until O'Connor just tacked on a 21-yard field goal. This is Jermaine Morera from his goal line. Morera out to the side and finally dragged down. Well, they love rings here in Huntington, West Virginia, and here's an alum that has lots of them. Janine Edwards.
Well, Joe, I'm here with Troy Brown, three-time Super Bowl MVP, plays with the New England Patriots, and he is second all-time to Randy Moss in career all-passage yards, right? All-purpose yards here. Coach Snyder brought you in to talk to the team in the spring. What'd you talk about?
We just talked about what it takes to win and what it takes to win on the field and off the field, you know, just about being good people and taking care of your teammates and trusting your teammates and going out and playing hard every play.
How the boys playing today?
They're playing hard. You know, we got up to a 10-0 lead, and we kind of lost it there and lost focus a little bit. And I think we're getting back on track now. We got a big interception just now and the field goal. So we're closing the gap.
No Teddy Bruschi, no Ty Law, among others, this year with the Patriots. What are you looking most forward to, and how does that impact the team?
Well, you know, we lost some good quality guys right there, and we got some guys in there to replace them. And not try to do what they did, but, you know, just come in and play the best game that they can play. And, you know, but we're looking good right now. I mean, we had a pretty good game the other night. A lot of mistakes to correct. And I think we'll be okay. You know, we got a big game next week in Carolina in the hot weather and see how we stand up to that and get a better read about our season, see if we got any better from last week.
Thanks, Troy.
Thank you. Thomas Clayton on the carry there. Pickup of two. Troy Brown the other night, six catches, 51 yards, and the beat just keeps on going and going for those Patriots, Ray.
Yeah, it's just amazing the program that they have up there. And, you know, we're talking about Bill Snyder and his effort to put the focus on the team by taking the names off the back of the jerseys. Well, that's something that Bill Belichick does so well with the Patriots. The focus is on the team.
Troy Brown, part of all those championships you see mounted here on Joan Edwards Stadium. This is a third down. Defense came up big last time against the K-State offense. Can they do it again? Allen Webb pressure, and Allen Webb is down. Albert McClellan, good surge from the freshman. 10-yard loss on third down, and the punting crew comes on for the Wildcats. So that's two good defensive stands now from Marshall, Ray.
Yeah, and this is a coverage sack because there's nowhere for Webb to go with the football. You see, he had the time initially. Hersher had a little bit of pressure coming from the right side, and then McClellan finished the thing off with a big sack, the first of his career.
Chubb Small is back deep. Tim Rayer.
Kansas State didn't have enough guys out there on that punt team. They had to run Norwood out.
That's not good, considering what happened last week with their punt team.
Right, had one block last week, and Mark Snyder said he would go after him today. And they went after that one, didn't get there.
High hanger, Chubb Small, right on the point of the attack. The flag goes down, so this probably is coming back.
Yeah, that's catch interference. You got to give him an opportunity to catch the football, and it was not given.
Yaman Figures was in there right away. Chubb Small trying to haul in that punt. See what Gil Gelpke has to say about this. Referee here today.
Fair catch interference on the kicking team, number 15. 15 yards from the spot of the foul. First down. Timeout.
So Marshall only trails by eight. Chubb Small interfered with there. Yaman Figures got there a little early. They'll have the ball when we come back.
From the plains of West Texas, where our miners call home, to the Carolina coast, where the Pirates roam, you'll find Owls, Tigers, Cougars, and Blazers. A place where the Hurricanes, Knights, and Eagles are golden, and the waves are all green.
Touchdown, Tulane!
We're running with the Mustangs and the Thunder and Herd. We're the new Conference USA. Get to know us.
Have mercy!
Get to know us better at ConferenceUSA.com.
How is K-State ranked nationally?
For the past 20 years, Kansas State has led the nation among public universities in Rhodes, Marshall, Truman, Goldwater, and Udall Scholars.
Is K-State up to date technology-wise?
K-State is recognized by the Princeton Review as one of the most connected campuses in the country, and by Intel as one of the most wireless.
What about campus life?
Dynamic, diverse, and a friendly atmosphere. Kansas State University.
Marshall will have the ball here in moments. 21-13, trailing by 8 against Kansas State here in Huntington. Well, if you want to know anything about college football, there's one place to go, and that is pick up the ESPN College Football Encyclopedia. It is the biggest, and I mean biggest, Ray. It's the richest reference guide ever published on the history of college football. You got all 119 Division I programs, the Ivy Leagues, the most prominent and historically black colleges, dating all the way back to 1869. It's available now wherever books are sold.
You said pick it up. You got to be strong to pick it up. That's about a 10-15 pound book there.
Let me tell you something. I carry that thing around with us doing our research, weighs about as much as a fourth grader. Here's Bradshaw swinging it out and loses yardage on the play. Good effort from Maurice Mack to come up from that linebacker position. 5-yard loss.
Yeah, Mack had man-to-man coverage on Bradshaw on that one. Got over there and made the big hit for a 5-yard loss.
Mark Snyder saw his team jump out, 10-zip, all that momentum, hyped-up crowd here, biggest crowd in the history of Joan C. Edwards Stadium, biggest opponent to ever come to Huntington, and they had things rolling, but then K-State came back, and now maybe a momentum shift here, just 2 minutes to go before the break.
Yeah, their defense has definitely been shored up the last two drives. They had a turnover and a 3-and-out.
Morris. Downfield, looked like there was contact. Let's check in.
A late flag came out on that because there was definitely contact over there.
Contact on the play. Matt Morris, Byron Garvin meeting up downfield.
Pass interference, number 6 on the defense. At the spot of the foul, it's a 1st and 10.
Let's go to Reese Davis for a halftime preview. Reese.
All right, Joe, coming up on the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report, Lou Holtz and Mark May will be alongside. We'll talk about the fallout from that Ohio U upset of Pitt. Also tell you what might be the key in the Texas-Ohio State game tonight. And also hear from James Carville as he talks about LSU's decision to play tonight, guys.
Ohio not far up the road here from Huntington, West Virginia. Big win last night. Coach Frank Solich.
Celebrating in Athens.
Indeed they are. Bernie Morris downfield once again. Wide open is Morris this time. Inside the 10. And he fumbles the ball. And K-State falls on it at the 2-yard line. Ted Sims. Oh, what a heartbreaker for Matt Morris.
Boy, I don't know how a guy gets that wide open, but he was open running right down the middle there was Morris. And he had a big play, but credit the Kansas State secondary for understanding that you're trying to rip the football out. And they got it out big time.
Yeah, ripped the football out, maybe ripped out the heart of Coach Mark Snyder because this was the comeback he was looking for.
Yeah, you see, look at this. There's the hit initially, and then the rip right there by Marcus Watts. Did a wonderful job of finishing a football play and then making a bad thing into a good thing with effort.
What a complete turnaround in a matter of moments. Bernie Morris found that open target. His first start ever, the emerging sophomore from Orlando. Matt Morris, you can see there, one of those 3 turnovers. So now K-State pinned against their own goal line. Not much there. Thomas Clayton unable to find space. Ian Hoskins came in on the tackle. And Matt Morris, you see him with his head down there. Going to try to shake that one off, but so tough to do.
Yeah, that's the thing, though. You know, there's a lot of football left, and they're going to need Matt Morris before this is over, so he's got to pull his head back up and get himself ready to continue to play. You can beat yourself up all weekend, all night, but right now you got to keep your mind focused and play football.
Marshall defense has come up solid the past 2 times they were on the field. See what they can do with K-State in their own end zone here. Clayton.
You know, earlier I was talking about the Marshall defense having just 6 in the box. Well, now they've got 8 in the box. And they're up there, and they are determined to stop the run, and they're doing it with numbers.
Going to have a timeout here.
Thank you.
So a minute to go before the half here in Huntington, West Virginia. Coach Mark Snyder. Only his second game. Third down and five coming up for K-State here. Joe Tessitore and Ray Bentley with you. Boy, kind of an interesting game in that all that momentum for Marshall early on. Then K-State, they came back with the explosive game breakers. But now it seems momentum was with Marshall right up until that moment of the reception from Matt Morris. But maybe an opportunity here defensively coming up.
And give Kansas State the credit for ripping that ball out. But I agree with you. Marshall has taken control, particularly on defense now. They're starting to shut down the run. They forced that turnover. They got the ball back to their offense the last two series. Now they're forced a third and six right here in this situation. So the defense has stepped it up definitely for Marshall.
I'll tell you, Ray, if there was one thing we knew about this game, we knew the Marshall front seven was going to have their struggles and maybe have their issues replacing the All-American and all seven starters. But the one thing we knew, there would be scoring.
you had to anticipate that because both teams are you know, struggling on defense. Kansas State last year, the defensive production dropped off, and they really weren't where they needed to be last week. And the same can be said for Marshall. So it's two young defenses that are kind of finding their way. So you're going to see kind of a little inconsistent play. And when you get that on defense, it leads to points on offense.
Well, let's see if the defense can step up here. Third down. Third and five to mark. K-State trying to open things up. They give it to Clayton. He's short of the first down, only picked up three. So the Marshall defense, led by inside linebacker Matt Couch, holds.
Yeah, Couch stepped up big. He's playing a lot better than he did early on. And he's a big, strong guy. He was a Ohio powerlifting state champion. Had a total of over 1,400 pounds combined between the bench press, the squat, and the deadlift. That's a lot of weight.
That's a lot of weight indeed. The junior from Ohio. Last week, he really had the play of the game against William and Mary. Hey, this Marshall team, this young Marshall team, was trailing Division I AA William and Mary late in the third quarter by one when Matt Couch scooped up a fumble and ran 70 yards and turned things around and put them on the board with a touchdown.
And give Chris Royal the assist on that. He's the one who forced that fumble.
Just a start to a good day of college football here on ESPN. Steve Spurrier heading down to play Georgia. South Carolina against number nine. Of course, DJ Shockley's something special. And then Jamarcus Randall and LSU. They will be taking on the high-flying Arizona State team, number five versus number 15, tonight at 9 o'clock. Here's Coach Bill Snyder looking to have that bounce-back year.
And I enjoyed our conversation with Bill Snyder. He's a little old school. He's been around. He's seen it all. And he knows how to get young men motivated.
Remember, Tim Rayer had a punt blocked last week for K-State. And Coach Mark Snyder of Marshall said, at some point, I'm coming after him. Not this time, though. Going to let it bounce. Crosses midfield. And all the way inside the 40-yard line of Marshall, that's where they will take over with just 41 seconds to go, a 50-yard punt. Want to remind you, coming up next, the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report. Reese Davis will have all the goods for us. Big day of college football. Last night, Pittsburgh upset by the Ohio Bobcats, and they'll set the table for the rest of the day of action.
I like to see the Mid-American Conference do well against some of those major teams, being a Central Michigan guy myself. And they didn't fare too well that first week, but it looks like they're turning things around this week.
Of course, Marshall was in the MAC up until last year, now part of Conference USA, a conference that has really come together in helping with the hurricane relief effort, of course, Tulane and Southern Miss, both greatly affected by the happenings down in the Gulf region. Bernie Morris goes out to the side, overthrows his intended target was Matt Morris.
There was a lot of coverage there, so he just overthrew it.
Want to remind you that the victims of the hurricane need your help. American Red Cross provides disaster victims with food, shelter, clothing. And your support of the American Red Cross Disaster Relief Fund helps victims of Hurricane Katrina, thousands of others. And to make a contribution, we really encourage you to do this. You can call 1-800-HELP-NOW or visit redcross.org.
Yeah, you know, it's been amazing is the generosity and the outpouring of this country to take care of those that are in need. Makes you proud to be an American.
Six defensive backs in now for K-State as Marshall's trying to generate something here with just 30 seconds to go in the half. And Bernie Morris right at that first down marker. And that's what Bernie Morris has when they talk about the all-around package. Got those wheels, Ray.
He's got the wheels, and he's got the good sense of knowing where that marker is and getting just enough for the first down and getting out of bounds to stop the clock. And, you know, this is his first start, really, is just his second extensive action. He only played in three games last year through one pass, so you really don't count much of that. Played quite a bit in the opener last week, but I think he's pretty well seasoned for how young he is.
So just short of midfield, 29 seconds to work with out of the shotgun for Bernie Morris. Flags come down.
Yeah, false start on the offense.
It's going to back him up. But you can sense the ebb and flow.
False start, number 66 on the offense. 5 yards, it remains first down.
Got the center on that, Doug Ligurski.
Breakfast in Huntington. We had an early 10:30 start this morning. We're at Joan C. Edwards Stadium. K-State looking to avenge their upset loss from 2 years ago at Marshall. I'm Joe Tessitore along with Ray Bentley and Janine Edwards. Lots of offense. Thomas Clayton has been the star. He has 2 touchdowns for K-State, but momentum has swung back to Marshall. Let's see if they can come up with something here in these last 29 seconds. Bernie Morris is something special. Maybe he has the magic. Downfield, incomplete. Hargrove was the intended receiver. Marcus Watts came in, and you can see now that is not a good sign in the offensive backfield.
No, and Morris got hit late by Watts. I don't want to say late because it wasn't a penalty type late, but just after he threw the football, and he's down on the ground right now, and that does not bode well.
Well, let's take a look at the quarterback pressure and the ensuing injury.
Right there is Watts. He's coming on that late delayed blitz, and you see him. He just buries his helmet right into the chest of Bernie Morris right there. And Morris, he took a full-on blow from Marcus Watts after he got rid of the football when he's at his most defenseless position. Now, if Morris isn't able to come back in, they are pretty good with Jimmy Skinner, who started the opener last week. And the coach called him a solid guy that will not make mistakes and will keep things going, called him a steady hand. So, you know, you hate to see this happened to Morris, but for the Marshall football team, they do have another guy that they can get it done with.
Yeah, and a guy who started last week's game, Jimmy Skinner, the junior, 6'3", 190 pounds. Last week, he was 11 of 17 for 98 yards. And we see Bernie Morris here, the Marshall crowd here starting to clap as he gets to his feet. That's the last thing, though, they wanted to see. This was his coming out party, and he was off to a pretty good start. Here's another look, Ray.
Yeah, take a listen. Bam, he got cracked right there, and that, you just hate to see your quarterback get hit like that in a defenseless position. And it looks, though, however, that Morris has been able to shake it off, and he's heading over the sideline. He's still got a couple of trainers that are tending to him, but we'll get a look at Skinner now.
So Jimmy Skinner will come in. Marcus Watts, by the way, who came in from that free safety position with all that speed behind him, they say, everybody in Kansas State says, he's by far the fastest player on the team, runs a 4-3, so he generates a lot of momentum when he comes in like that untouched against the quarterback. So Jimmy Skinner with just 26 seconds to go. Last week's starter, this week's replacement. Sets up the screen to Bradshaw, and it hit the ground.
Yeah, and you can see that just isn't quite ready with his arm. And that's an easy pass, just a little 5-6 yard screen pass, and he underthrew that. Bradshaw was able to scoop it, but the ruling on the field was that ball did hit the ground. You see Skinner looking at his wristband for the play call. That wristband has some extensive information on it. You see that thing right there? Well, that wristband, they have 204 plays on that wristband.
Now, it's interesting you bring up the number of plays on the wristband. I know the other night the crew on Monday Night Football is talking about Tom Brady only having 120. 204 in college, 120 for Tom Brady.
Yeah, I guess you need more in college.
Bradshaw going to close out this first half. Gets the ball close to midfield. Pickup of 7. And that'll be it for the Marshall offense that was running pretty smoothly with quarterback Bernie Morris, but he was injured with just 29 seconds to go. Want to remind you, coming up next, the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report. Ahmad Bradshaw got them on the board with a 6-yard touchdown run. Marshall was up 10-0. May have one last play here.
Timeout. Marshall, their third.
Yeah, and I think you have to take that timeout.
Yeah,
I'm surprised they didn't do it sooner. But, yeah, you got one more shot. Let's, you know.
Never know what's going
to
happen.
Try to make something happen. You know, you're at midfield, too, so there is room.
Well, Jimmy Skinner, we told you he was last week's starter. His first play of the first game was a 60-plus-yard in-the-air completion. So he can put it up there.
Yeah, he hit Wilbur Hargrove right on that first play for that 66-yarder.
See Jimmy Skinner talking things over. Last year, Marshall, they always go big game hunting. And last year, they were up in Columbus taking on number 9 Ohio State. Their future coach, Mark Snyder, was trying to stop Marshall back then. Played the Buckeyes score for score, tying the game at 21 for the fourth. Mike Nugent, though, would bail out the Buckeyes. The new New York Jets kicker won it with a 55-yard field goal as time expired. And Bobby Pruitt walked away 24-21, coming up just short. And now, well, he's changed colors. Mark Snyder now walking the Marshall sidelines where he was once a star player. Boy, he said Coach Jim Tressel said, hey, it's the right fit, it's the right time, this is your job.
He has so much respect for Coach Tressel, calls him Tress. Said he taught him how to be a man, taught him how to win, taught him how to be a father.
Well, the Hail Mary goes to the 9-yard line where Justin McKinney makes the play. So nothing doing there. Jimmy Skinner closes out the first half at quarterback for Marshall. Bernie Morris got the start. There's Allen Webb, who led the K-State offense to 3 consecutive scores. They lead 21-13. Let's go to Janine Edwards with Coach Bill Snyder.
I can't wait.
Coach, you told us that your team needed a more gap-oriented, more responsible defense. What are they showing you so far today?
Well, I think we played well on defense. We just have to be careful about penalties and turnovers. That's what's cost us in this ball game so far.
A deficit of team spirit was a problem last year. What are you seeing so far?
Well, I think in the first two ball games, at least first game and a half, that we've showed adequate spirit with our football team.
Thanks, Coach.
You're welcome. Thank you.
A spirited offensive half of football. K-State 21-3. Now let's join Reese, Lou, and Mark in the studio for the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report.
All right, Joe, so an 8-point lead for the Wildcats at the break, and Marshall could actually be in much better shape. The interception that they took back into Kansas State territory mustered only a field goal. Then the strip on the long completion close to the goal line. Mark, how much do those type of things weigh on you, the missed opportunities, when you're probably outmanned a little bit?
Well, they weigh on you a lot because in a game where you're outmanned, you can't make mental mistakes like that, and you can't turn the ball over, particularly when you pick up long yardage situations. But I think if you go back to Kansas State, I think they've got Thomas Clayton now. He's a great replacement for Darren Sproles at the running back position. 177 yards rushing last week, 75 in the first quarter, 45 yards receiving, a touchdown pass receiving, a touchdown running. I think he's the perfect replacement for Darren Sproles, but he's bigger, stronger, maybe just as fast.
But let's also give Kansas State credit. They were down 10-0 away from home in a hostile environment, and they fought back to take a 21-10 lead. That's easy to think that you can do it very easily, but it's not.
Yeah, you just don't stroll into Joan C. Edwards Stadium in Huntington, West Virginia, and walk out with a victory, Lou. You know that. You don't do that.
Well,
we'll have James Carville joining us in just a little bit. And you know what else? You don't just stroll into Peden Stadium in Athens, Ohio, thinking you're the Pitt Panthers and you're going to win easily. We'll talk about it in a bit.
Welcome back to the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report.
2 years ago, Marshall went into Manhattan when Kansas State was number 6, knocked off the Wildcats. Now K-State trying to win on Marshall's turf, 21-13 at the break. Glad to have you along on the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report. On Friday night, Pittsburgh coming off that disappointing performance against Notre Dame last Saturday night, having to go on the road against a MAC school, potentially a little bit of a letdown situation, to take on Ohio U and Frank Solich. Now, Solich, the former Nebraska coach, averaged almost 10 wins per season at Nebraska, but things didn't get off to a great start for the Fighting Frankies. Opening kickoff in Pittsburgh, where Rod Stevens howling is burning right down the sidelines, 95 yards, and just like that, the Panthers are on top 7-0. But the offensive threat is a defensive back for the Bobcats, maybe.
Deion Byram, prime time. Deion will take it in and ties the score at 7-7.
38-yard pick six. He also scored a touchdown against Northwestern, and here's Deion.
Intercepted. Once again, Deion Byram, who picked off a pass and ran it back for a score earlier, and he's going to win the game for Ohio. Touchdown, Bobcats.
And Dave Wannstedt falls to 0-2 at Pittsburgh, first time since 1984, 16-10, a huge win for Frank Solich as he tries to build a program at Ohio U. Now, before all of the internet folks go crazy and you start putting websites up there about Dave Wannstedt, let's take a half step back here and get a little perspective about what it takes, Coach, for a transition period when you take over a new program, because at times they're doing different things than what they did under Walt Harris on offense.
Well, a first-year head coach has an obligation to take the personnel he has and to utilize it with an appropriate offense and defense. I went to the University of Notre Dame. Steve Beuerlein's our quarterback. I want to run the option. We couldn't run the option with Steve Beuerlein because it would be a delay of game penalty. It was so slow. So we had to run the quick passing game. We had to do things with his talent. But eventually, we were able to recruit the type of talent we needed to run the offense and defense that I believed in. But you have to adjust as a head coach because you owe it to your players. You owe it to your seniors to give them a chance to win before they leave school.
Now, it's only two games, Mark, but is Wannstedt doing that right now in the early going? I know it's early.
No, he's not doing that. You got Tyler Pelko, a quarterback that can throw the ball all over the field. Greg Lee, one of the best wide receivers in college football. You go to him the first series at Notre Dame, what happens? You get a touchdown. You don't go back to him. You got to continue to go to the well with your best players. That's how you make things happen. But what's frustrating to me, the entire offseason, Dave Wannstedt preached to everyone, we're going to be tougher. We're going to recruit big linemen from what we had in the past at the University of Pittsburgh. We're going to knock people off the ball. I didn't see that last night against Ohio. They got knocked off the ball defensively, and their offensive linemen couldn't knock anyone off the ball. That's what's very frustrating.
But very fortunate for Frank Solich. Yes. It's a great win for Ohio U against a school from the Big East. All right, let's do a little speed rush. Lou, this is how this works. I'm going to put a minute and 30 seconds on the clock. Okay. I'll address a question to each of you guys. Should you beg to differ with the opinion of the other, you'll be granted one timeout during the course of the game in which you can challenge the other's point of view. You guys ready to go?
Ready? Yes, sir.
All right, let's put a minute, 30 seconds on the clock. Wind the clock now. Lou, can Notre Dame beat Michigan?
Notre Dame can not only beat Michigan, they will beat Michigan. Both offenses are great. I think Notre Dame's defense is better than Michigan's.
All right, Mark, after last week, why in the world should we think that South Carolina can hang with Georgia?
You shouldn't think that because they can't hang with Georgia. DJ Shockley, 6 touchdowns last week, 5 in the air, 1 on the ground. Remember, South Carolina couldn't run the football against UCF. You're calling timeout?
Timeout for Lou.
Hey, you're an intelligent individual, but I want to tell you, the University of South Carolina has excellent defense. They have great corners. Georgia has DJ Shockley. That's all they have on offense. They have a great coach. South Carolina will win this football game.
You ever heard of Danny Ware, Craig Lumpkin?
All right, I got to wind the clock. Okay. I got to wind the clock. Lou, who wins, Arizona State or LSU?
LSU will win the football game. They're far more talented. Also, I think they're going to come together because of the emotional ties to the state and the travesty they've endured.
All right, Mark, I want you to listen to this question carefully. What will Ohio State speed do to Texas?
Nothing. Texas has more speed overall than Ohio State. They've got a speed coach at Ohio State. We saw that package earlier. Forget about that. Texas has better athletes from top to bottom, more speed from top to bottom than Ohio State. That will prove in this game that they have better athletes, in my opinion, from top to bottom on both sides of the ball.
All right, each of you get a chance to answer this one. We will start with you. Who would be hurt the most by losing today? Notre Dame, Michigan, Texas, or Ohio State?
Whoever loses the football game, that coach is not going to sleep tonight, I'll promise you that. But I think the University of Texas, because they have such high ambitions. I think they also have an easier conference this year with a loss that Oklahoma had. So I think they can look and say, We can win the national championship if we get by this game.
I'm not going to use my time out here, but Texas can lose this game and still come back and win the Big 12 championship and get to the Rose Bowl if things go well for them. The team that will lose the most today is Michigan. They're ranked too high right now. They lose this game to Notre Dame, a team that was unranked in the preseason. They'll fall so low, they'll be hurt the most.
All right, and that is Speed Rush. You guys almost even got it in before the clock ran out, too. Almost no delay of game penalty, no Burline anywhere to be found. We continue on the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report. There is the Florida State transfer, Thomas Clayton, going for the Wildcats. K-State up by 8 at the break.
The Pontiac Performance Halftime Report is powered by Pontiac. Nominate your game-changing performance at ESPN.com. Keyword Pontiac. This is the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report.
Tremendous doubleheader coming up for you tonight on ESPN. Head ball coach goes back between the hedges to take on Georgia and an LSU on the road at Arizona State, 9 o'clock Eastern Time. South Carolina, Georgia, LSU, Arizona State, available in high definition. And pleased to be joined now by political strategist and LSU graduate James Carville. James, thanks a lot for taking some time to be with us. What do you think of LSU's decision to play this game?
You know, all I know is what I hear from Louisiana. Obviously, they could not play it in Tiger Stadium because the Assembly Center, as they call it, the PMAC, is a medical facility. And you just couldn't tie up traffic like that. I think the logistical problems were just overwhelming for them. So I assume that this was the best of a lot of not very good alternatives.
Well, now, football is a part of the fabric in Louisiana, and certainly you know that very well. How can a football game help help the healing process?
Oh, God, let me count the ways. I'd say football is close to, you know, it's in football is, you know, there's family, food, and football, and not a whole lot else that we're passionate about, but we are passionate about those three things. And, you know, football brings the other two together. I mean, all over the state of Louisiana, just stunned the how many families are going to be gathered around this television set, what it's going to mean to them. It's always meant a lot to us. I've never seen anything where one team so dominates the psyche of the state as the LSU Tiger football team dominates the psyche of the state of Louisiana. It's the only major conference team in the entire state, and people just get behind it like you wouldn't believe. And I tell you, these 19, 20-year-old, they're not kids, they're young men, have a lot on their shoulders tonight. I mean, they didn't have the opening game. They didn't get a game under their belt. They were supposed to be at home. They're not. They've been have really adverse circumstances. I suspect the fifth of the football team probably comes from affected areas. So this is going to, you pick the word, character, guts, you know, whatever you want to come up with. I think you're going to see it all tonight in Tempe.
James, I got about 20 seconds here. There have to be those who are opposed to playing this game. What would you say to those who might say it's insensitive?
I don't think that very many people, that's something that I don't detect back home. And let me tell you, man, everybody that I talk to wants desperately for LSU, not just to play the game, we want to win the damn thing. I want them to win the game. I mean, I understand it. We're playing a top 25 team, but I'm not for playing it. I'm for winning the doggone thing. And I don't get a sense that there's a lot of people at home that don't want this to go. If they do, they don't understand the state. They don't understand what it means to people who've had just this awful, awful 2 weeks, what this can mean to them. So I know one thing. I'm going to be by the TV, and I'm going to be pulling for my Tigers.
James, thanks a lot. Always a pleasure.
You bet.
And don't forget, that game in Tempe tonight could raise over $1 million for the relief effort for those affected by Hurricane Katrina. Kansas State on top of Marshall at the half. Back with more after this.
The Pontiac Performance Halftime Report is powered by Pontiac. Nominate your game-changing performance at ESPN.com. Keyword Pontiac.
In the world of learning, exciting ideas come to inquisitive minds, led by distinguished professors like Marshall University's David Castleberry.
When we rehearse great music, we learn more than notes and rhythms. We engage in critical thinking,
At Marshall, we are engaging ideas, award-winning faculty, and dedicated to fulfilling the promise for a bright future.
Notre Dame and Michigan underway, 12th place, 76-yard drive. Brady Quinn, Raymond McKnight, just as easy as pie. The Fighting Irish on top, not even 3 minutes in the Big House, 7-0 over number 3 Michigan. It appears to be quite easy for Charlie Weiss as he schemes that thing. Now let's check out some more scores now. A game going on over on ESPN. Clemson and Maryland underway, and the Tigers, after that scintillating victory over Texas A&M, now up on Maryland in the snake pit of Bird Stadium, 7-0. Reggie Merriweather with 10 yards and scoring the touchdown for Tommy Bowden's team. And Wisconsin against Temple. Temple got throttled by Arizona State, 3-0 there in the early going there. Of course, Brian Calhoun coming off that 258-yard day for the Badgers. Ahmad Bradshaw has had a pretty good first half for Marshall. Marshall thundering herd down by 8. Second half's coming.
Close. That big fella, 6'5", he just leans and he can get you about 2 yards. Yeah, no doubt about it. They rule it pretty quick for first down for Maryland. Here, all you're trying to do is just get some push up front. Get behind your center and your guard. Just wedge in there as much as you can. Try to keep your foot from slipping. He slipped a little bit, but he was still able to get the surge he needed in order to pick up the first down.
Hollenbach wants to throw. Dangerous pass, almost intercepted out in the flat. Sergio Gilliam not only had almost an interception, but almost a touchdown there.
Yeah, he was hugging the line of scrimmage pretty.
In the second half, the Marshall fans, they have packed Joan C. Edwards Stadium. Largest crowd in the history of this fine, great football tradition here. Biggest name opponent that's ever come to town. And they got off to such a great start behind the leadership of their sophomore quarterback, Bernie Morris, but he was banged up at the end of the first half. K-State will get the ball here to start things off. As we are ready for action, Ian O'Connor is going to be kicking off for the Thundering Herd. Connor's boot high, going to come down just at about the goal line to Jermaine Morera. Speedy return man coming to the left side looking for a hole, and he finds it. Flag comes down as Morera crosses midfield and turns on the Jets. Trying to go all the way, and he does, but the penalty marker laying all the way back at the 24-yard line. Most likely will negate a 99-yard return by Jermaine Morera.
Yeah, it's holding.
Holding. Number 9 on the receiving team at the spot of the flag. 10 yards. First down.
Bill Snyder really focused for this game, as was Jermaine Morera on this kickoff. You know, he's really explosive, but there's the hold there.
And it's Kyle Williams that makes the hold. You can see it right up in here. And that's just a takedown deal, and that one comes back. And that's too bad, because I'll tell you, Morera has been close on a previous couple of returns of busting that. And a lot of guys held their blocks for a long time, but they held their blocks.
Let's check in with Janine Edwards. Janine?
Hey, Joe. Well, I spoke to Coach Mark Snyder just a couple of moments ago, and I asked him, how are you guys going to defend the run a little bit better and stop Thomas Clayton? He said, right now, we are playing way too predictable on defense. He said, they've got some great coaches over on the other side of that field. We're going to change some things up. Last week, they collapsed in the third quarter, Marshall did. He said during halftime, he told the guys, I do not want a repeat of last week. And as for quarterback Bernie Morris, they think he has a sprained shoulder. They did x-rays on it. He is not coming back into the game, guys.
Well, this will drive a coach crazy. Play clock was running down on the first play of the second half, and they have to burn a timeout.
Yeah, and you can see the irritation on Coach Bill Snyder over there on the sidelines. He's going to check with some people and find out what was the problem here.
Had a lot of time to think things over at the half. as to what you want to run, and the play clock runs out here only 15 seconds into this third quarter. Beautiful day here. Actually, they're not going to charge him with a timeout because there was an issue with the clock. So, nonetheless, Joe Tessitore, Ray Bentley, Janine Edwards, so glad you're with us to start off this college football spectacular Saturday. Thomas Clayton, you can see his numbers there. The K-State running back off to another great start. There's Allen Webb, who has led the way to a 21-13 Wildcats lead. Coach Bill Snyder, 17 years in, probably the greatest rebuilding job of all time with what he did with K-State back in the late 80s through the glory years, and now looking to bounce back after a 4-7 season. Webb, nothing happening there. Really nice pursuit. Chris Royal coming up from the free safety position, a loss of 2 yards.
Well, that's about what Gene talked about, the different looks now from the Marshall defense, and one of those different looks is go ahead and bring this safety up, and there's Royal right there, and you see him. He's closing quickly, and when you can bring a safety up and he can make a tackle for a 2 yard loss, that means he knows what he's doing. And also it's a deal where the defensive coordinator is now mixing things up, and Jim Collins does a great job for the Thundering Herd, and he called a good one there.
Chris Royal's been so active coming up to that line, making some big plays. Now a second down and 12. Pitch to Clayton. Cuts it back against the grain, close to the 20-yard line. Matt Weiner is in the studio with an update. Matt?
An easier 1A win than scheduling Temple. Wisconsin did that in early dividends. John Stocko to Owen Daniels. Badgers up 10-0 at Camp Randall.
Third down and 5 for K-State. First possession here of the third quarter, leading by 8. The Thundering Herd trying to create some thunder among their fans and come up with another defensive stop. Play action, pressure, Webb gets free, trying to chase him down, and he does not complete the pass. Right into the ground. It was intended for Rashad Norwood, who tried to make a play on it. The quarterback pressure.
That was DeMarcus Thomas, who came first on the blitz from the outside. He played that bootleg perfectly. All he forgot to do was make the tackle. Here he is on the outside up here. Look at him come. He's going right to bootleg. Played bootleg the whole way, but the elusiveness of Webb kind of kept that play alive, and then you had good pursuit from Underwood, forcing Webb to just throw a bad ball. But again, a good mix from that Marshall defense. They're changing things up. They're playing responsibility defense, and if they can make tackles, they're going to be all right.
So Coach Snyder there on the sidelines, he has to be very pleased with the way his defense came out here in the third quarter compared to last week.
Yeah, they got run up pretty good in the third quarter last week. And this is a possibility of a replay challenge here. The Conference USA rules are in effect, and that means there is a replay official upstairs who is reviewing every play, recording as it goes, and if he sees something, he will page the referee and have him look at it.
Please announce. Please announce that we will have no objects being thrown at the Kansas State team out of the stadium. Anyone caught doing that will be dealt with.
Dealt with severely, I hope.
So admonishing the crowd is referee Gil Gelke. Biggest crowd here at Joan C. Edwards Stadium history. Getting behind their defense and maybe getting a little too rowdy, and can't have people throwing stuff at the opposing team. Safety always the concern.
Right, you don't want what happened in that movie Slapshot.
Not indeed. Tim Rayer to punt. High hanging spiral kick. Takes a bounce off to the side and goes out of bounds at the 41-yard line. Marshall will have a new quarterback on the field when we come back. They trail by 8. K-State, but that Marshall defense is really manned up Look what they've done, Ray.
Well, this is Kansas State's defense, and you're right. Marshall's defense has manned up, but Kansas State defense playing very well. Three and outs in a row. They forced three turnovers, and Marshall just one of six on third downs. That's very good defensive production. And, you know, early on we talked about the offensive fireworks in this game. It has now settled into a defensive struggle. Both defenses have kind of settled in there, and they're playing very good football right now.
Yeah, Marshall holding K-State to three straight three and outs, and K-State likewise on the other side, as we just showed you. Nearly 37,000 here at Joan C. Edwards Stadium. And the delay here with 13:01 to go in the third is we had an announcement moments ago that everybody wants clarified as to the crowd throwing objects to the Kansas State team on the sidelines, and the referee already made a public announcement about that. And that's the last thing we want to see, is any disruption here and any threat to the safety of the coaches or players. Yeah, largest crowd ever here in Huntington.
You just can't have that. I mean, that's not, the fans have certain rights, but one of them is not throwing objects onto the field. And you should be immediately arrested and ejected for that kind of behavior, and I believe that's what will happen here.
Coach Mark Snyder, second game here at Marshall. Took the job real late, Ray. You know, he only had a practice left in spring practice when he accepted the head coaching job. That's a real late start, especially in terms of getting your staff together.
Right, getting the staff together and also just getting your life together, moving to a new city. Now, the good news for Mark Snyder was that he played at Marshall. His wife, Beth, is from nearby Ironton, so the family, they knew this area, and so it wasn't like he had to learn about, all right, where's the bank, where's the shopping center, where are all these things. He was like coming home for him, and that made that transition that much easier.
Of course, the crowd here in Marshall, 36,914 of them here, and what the delay was for is because after the announcement was made, there were still objects being thrown towards Kansas State. Let's go to Janine Edwards.
Well, Joe, I just heard that evidently it's the student section over here on the Kansas State side that has been throwing various things such as cups and ice and drinks down towards the Kansas State players on the sideline.
Now, I know they're real ramped up, big name opponent in town, but they got to control themselves there. Hopefully that'll be the case. 13:01 here in the third. Marshall ball, Bradshaw up the middle, not much, just about a pickup of one. Ted Sims, the middle linebacker, with the tackle.
And this offense will change a little bit with Jimmy Skinner at the quarterback position. You can throw out the quarterback draw and the designed quarterback runs, the option stuff. That's really not Skinner's bag of tricks. He's more of a drop back kind of quarterback, a steady guy who will get you in good situations and make very few mistakes.
I think steady is a real good word to describe Jimmy Skinner. He's serviceable, 6'3", 190 pounds, from Ohio. Started last week against William and Mary before Morris came in and had three touchdowns, and he threw in the coverage here. We're going to get a flag. Wilbur Hargrove was the intended receiver.
And both Baldwin and Mack on the defense, and one of them got there early, if not both.
Pass interference, number three on the defense. Penalty is assessed at the spot of the foul. First down.
So they get Brian Baldwin, the sophomore from St. Louis.
You know, and I feel bad for Baldwin because usually this ball comes out quicker. You're going to see Skinner holds it, and then lets it go. And then you have the contact late, as Baldwin's used to that ball coming out a little quicker, and he closed with his coverage. And it's really kind of hard to see the disruption on that one.
First down for the Thundering Herd. You see the penalties there. K-State 5 for 50. Skinner being rushed, puts it out there. And he was either overthrowing Hiram Moore or underthrowing and misreading Hargrove. Quentin Eccles from that defensive tackle position came in and pressured the quarterback, and that's a whole lot of Quentin Eccles coming at you.
Yeah, he's a large man, and the other guy involved with that was Brandon Archer. He's going to be the outside linebacker, and you're not going to be able to see him, but he's going to be coming from this side, and he's going to come on a blitz over here, and he's going to kind of cut things off. You see him right here, he shows up, and that cuts off the rollout by Skinner, and it makes him stop short, and that allows Eccles the time to close from behind and get the hit on the quarterback.
Second and 10, swings it out to Hiram Moore. Beats the first man and has a Marshall first down. Very nice effort from Hiram Moore. Byron Garvin missed the tackle there. 16-yard pickup.
And that's what Skinner will do for you. He's steady. He can make this kind of throw. You're going to see the route there, just a bubble route over there by Moore, and then a good run after the catch. Got the block out there, but a well-thrown ball and an accurate ball, and you really need that on that bubble type of screen so that the runner can get upfield immediately, and Skinner does that well.
So Skinner coming in from Bernie Morris, moving the offense here early in the third quarter. Back to pass again. This time going deep, incomplete. Let's check in with Matt Weiner for a Virginia Tech Duke update. Matt?
Hi, Joe. Frank Beamer called Marcus Vick's performance against NC State fantastic despite not great numbers. Off to a good start today. Vick to Jeff King in the corner of the end zone. Hokies on top 7-0. Notre Dame and Michigan. The Irish go 12 plays, 77 yards in their opening drive. Wolverines getting nothing done offensively, and it remains 7-0 with Notre Dame having the ball.
Thanks, Matt. Big game in the big house, and we have a good game right here in Huntington. Marshall trailing by 8. They lost their emerging star quarterback, Bernie Morris, and now Jimmy Skinner on second down and 10 out of the shotgun. That was a ground ball right there, right?
Yeah, just after I say how good Jimmy Skinner is at throwing that type of pass, he lets me down and throws that one into the dirt. He was upset with himself after that one. He kind of slapped himself in the head. And you just don't see a whole lot of that from Skinner. He's very accurate on the underneath stuff. And that's a disappointment for him and for the Marshall offense that he's not able to make that kind of easy throw.
Jimmy Skinner, 1 of 6, 11 yards. Interception that came on the Hail Mary at the end of the first half, so we'll give him a pass on that. Last week he was 11 of 17 for 98 yards. Justin McKinney comes in as the nickelback here on third down and 10. Skinner, he's got time this time over the middle. It is complete once again. Hiram Moore with the first down reception, as Jimmy Skinner does himself well that time and converts the third down, a pickup of 14.
Boy, and Kansas State voided the middle of the field, and that just allowed Hiram Moore to get right into the middle. Here's Moore coming on the inside route. He's just kind of a search route, just going to go into the middle of the field and try to find an open spot. And the linebackers did not get back and take away anything underneath, and that's an easy throw for Skinner to a wide open Moore.
Skinner has some good targets. You see Hiram Moore there. A lot of shifting from this Marshall offense. Bradshaw gets the call. Stretch play to the left side. Pickup of 2. Cut down by Kyle Williams, the strong safety.
Marshall's putting together a pretty good drive right here. Converted a couple of third downs in the passing game from Skinner. His two completions, both of them garnered first downs for Marshall. They're and a nice little mix. The offense is definitely more under control with Skinner back there at quarterback. What I mean by that, they're not trying to do a whole lot with the quarterback like we saw earlier with Morris running the football and scrambling and those things. It's more of a direct approach with Skinner.
Eighth play of this drive now. They've gained 33 yards. Nothing doing here, though. Bradshaw wrapped up by Brandon Archer. Archer's name hasn't been called out much today, but Archer is a 6'2", 225-pounder from St. Paul, team captain. And this is a guy that you read a lot of the preseason publications and people say, hey, he could be all Big 12.
Yeah, he's got a lot of talent. You know, he runs extremely well. He's the linebacker that they use in coverage more than anything. He can match up and cover any tight end, and he can be a special ball player.
So third and 10. Marshall just 2 of 7 on third downs today. Skinner swings it out to Bradshaw, and Bradshaw once again not much there. Brian Baldwin came right up and made the play from his cornerback position, so the K-State defense, boy, you're able to stop him on third down.
You're just not going to fool Brian Baldwin. He knows what he's doing out there, and you're going to see Baldwin, he's going to be the cornerback that'll show up here on the right side of the screen. Right there he is, And you see him, he's just playing flat coverage, was disciplined, stayed over there where he should, saw the receiver come out and reacted accordingly.
47-yard attempt for Ian O'Connor. No good. That may have been deflected up at the line, Ray.
Yeah, I think it was blocked. It was Alfonso Moran, big number 50, who got through there. He had the penetration and got the hand up, and I believe he blocked it.
So K-State, bend, don't break. They do indeed. They lead by 8. They'll have the ball when we come back.
ESPN 2's College Football, brought to you by Lexus and their passionate pursuit of perfection. And Papa John's Pizza. Order online at papajohns.com.
Yeah, you want pizza, you go to Papa John's, but you want yourself a good porterhouse and some football memorabilia when you visit Huntington, you go to Bobby Pruitt's Steakhouse. The legendary coach won more games than any other coach in Marshall history, national title in 1AA back in 96, and today is Bobby Pruitt Day here at Edwards Stadium. 21-13, K-State on top with the ball. Webb's going to keep it himself. Matt Weiner, update us on Virginia Tech and Duke, please.
Joe, the Hokies are 50-8 under Frank Beamer when they score a defensive or special teams touchdown, and that does not bode well for Duke. Mike Schneider picked off 3 times last week, another time here. Rolly Miner with the impressive run back. Hokies on top, 14-0 on the road.
Yeah, Matt, week after week, you start taking a look at these defenses in the ACC from Georgia Tech and NC State, FSU, Miami, Vatech, and BC. Boy, top to bottom, what defense has played in that conference? Second down and 5 now. Webb, another quarterback run, design play, which they'll do a lot at Kansas State. Picks up 4 yards. It'll bring up a 3rd down and 1. Floyd Wright had the tackle.
The Marshall defense, you talk about defenses, they have begun to play extremely well. They forced the 3 and outs the last 2 possessions, and they got a turnover the one prior to that, and now they're forced another 3rd down situation for the Wildcats. And they have shored things up against the run, and that's the big difference.
See Gavin Hersher there getting in on that play. And 7 new starters in that front 7. Marshall looking to come up with a stop here, 3rd and 1.
Marshall showing blitz right here. You see all these bodies up there up to the line, and Webb didn't like it, didn't have the play that he needed against that blitz that they showed, so he called that timeout. I think that's a heads-up play by Webb, because obviously the situation he was in, it wasn't going to work out, and this is a big 3rd down.
And you can see they have 2 timeouts remaining. Want to clarify that at the beginning of this half, that was not a charged timeout when the play clock ran down. There was something wrong with the play clock, so they weren't charged with a timeout, but they're going to talk things over here. Coach Bill Snyder, offensive coordinator Del Miller. He's in his 9th season as the O-Cord. You're going to try to figure out something for 3rd and 1. Let's check in with Janine Edwards. Janine?
Well, Joe, for just the 2nd game and the 1st time ever here at Joan Edwards Stadium, the Thundering Herd is playing on field turf. It was installed and completed just about a month ago at the cost of about $855,000. It is now in 30 D1 stadiums across the country. And the old surface, which was AstroTurf, the officials here at Marshall said, you know what, public funds paid for this surface. We're going to go ahead and give it back to the public. So they had a special day. They laid it out in the parking lots, and they said whoever wants it can come get it. And a couple of area schools took some, and a lot of people have this framed in their living room, so I've been told.
Yeah, that field turf, unlike the painted green asphalt that Ray Bentley played his NFL career on.
Yeah, I've got pieces of cartilage spread all over the country from that stuff.
3rd and 1. I formation, 2 tight ends for K-State, and there was movement. You left a lot of DNA on some of those NFL turfs, right?
Get little pieces of me spread all over the country. But there, that was a big mistake by the Marshall defense. Got anxious, and a good call by.
Prior to the snap, offsides, number 52 on the defense. Penalty results in a 1st down.
A good job of using that long count there on a 3rd and short situations, and that's a good job by Webb drawing people offsides.
Marshall thundering herd here at Joan C. Edwards Stadium, 103-7. Their last loss came in 2003 to Detroit Trojans. Only major college football stadium named in honor of a woman. Mrs. Edwards had generously given more than $50 million to support this fine university.
Wow. Talk about the benefactor.
Mm-hmm. So a first down for the Wildcats. Four wide receivers, and Webb will keep it himself. Gets to the edge and gets to midfield. Dante Newsome able to come over and make the play against Webb.
That's the fourth carry by Webb on this drive, and they really feel like they're trying to get him involved more in the running game, because Marshall has done a good job now of shutting down Thomas Clayton, who was very explosive early in the ball game, but hasn't been able to do much since then.
K-State up by 8. They had 21 unanswered points after Marshall jumped up 10-0. Now at midfield, halfway through this third quarter. Six defensive backs in. They're going to have to defend Jordy Nelson. He is very shifty, and he has a first down. Let's get an update on Clemson-Maryland from Matt Weiner. Matt.
It's over on ESPN. Couple of teams coming off dramatic wins last week. Cole Chasen is the Clemson puncher, and Cole's in a world of hurt. Over his head, he does gather it up inside the 5, but Maryland takes over, and Sam Hollenbach goes fourth. Terps up 10-7 in the second.
Good game going on there. Of course, Maryland coming off of that great atmosphere against Navy last week. Nice to see the two local schools play down there. First down and 10 now. Four receivers, six DBs. Flag comes in.
And Webb is being very effective with his cadence now, and he's drawing that Marshall defense off sides. That's twice in the last three plays he's been able to pull them off by going on two or three.
Prior to the snap, offsides, number 38 on the defense, 5 yards, remains first down.
That one on DeMarcus Thomas, but you can see the head bob and the work by Allen Webb in trying to draw Marshall offsides. Take a look at him.
Here it is from Webb.
You see him when he kind of gives that little body language when he barks out that count. And Marshall has to go back to fundamentals. The defensive lineman, you watch the football and you move when the ball moves. You got to be deaf to that quarterback.
Seems simple, doesn't it, Roy?
It's simple, but it's not easy.
Exactly. So it's a first down and 5. That's a lot of fun for an offensive coordinator. First and 5, Webb. Being pressured, looking for an answer, can't find it. Nice surge from the front four of Marshall. Juan Underwood, big 6'3", 300-pounder, getting in the mix.
Yeah, and they brought Chris Royal on the blitz as well. And he's the guy that actually gets through. You see your front four coming up there, but here's Royal coming late on that blitz again, and he's the one who kind of flushed Webb out of the pocket back into those big defensive linemen.
And yeah, then the big 300-pounder Underwood just laid on top of him, and thus it brings up a second down and 7 for K-State. Trying to get themselves into scoring position here. Referees really kind of a choppy flow to this third quarter all of a sudden, Ray.
Well, you've had the fans throwing things, and then you've had play clock problems, exactly. And it kind of takes the rhythm out of things. And I believe that was another play clock issue.
You know, in K-State, as they showed us in the first quarter, they're kind of a rhythm team. When they get going offensively, they start to click.
Exactly.
So we'll see if they can get that rhythm back here on 2nd and 7. Clayton is the back right next to Webb, and he gets the call. Good blocking out in front, trying to get over that pile, and it looks like he's got a first down with a 7-yard pickup. Nice run by Thomas Clayton.
Boy, he ran Chris Royal right over to get that first down yardage. Marshall came with a blitz. You're going to see two linebackers right up in here, and they're both bringing the blitz. That means run support has to come from the defensive secondary. And it did, but you're going to get when you get a big man like Thomas Clayton running up in there at 6 feet, 225 pounds. He's going to run over a 5'9", 185-pound Chris Royal, and that's what happened.
Chris Royal run over. Curtis Keyes was looking up at the sky. So a first down. Now here's that quarterback run again. Allen Webb. 4:44 and counting here in the third. 21-3, K-State on top of Marshall, trying to avenge the loss the upset from 2 years ago. We're here in Huntington, West Virginia. I'm Joe Tessitore alongside Ray Bentley and Janine Edwards and Thomas Clayton. The total yardage up there, 90 rushing, 45 receiving, 2 touchdowns on the day. He has led the way for K-State, filling those big shoes of Darren Sproles. Second down and 6 for K-State. The line to make is the 22. Nice looking play here. Coming around Thomas Clayton, but also good defensive presence. And you can see DeMarcus Thomas stayed where he was supposed to. So what looked to be a good looking play as they had the fake and then coming around with Clayton on the handoff just ended up being a good defensive play.
Right, watch Clayton right here. This is the old Statue of Liberty play. You're going to see Webb fake the throw like that and then just lay it to the running back Clayton coming around. Good discipline by the defense there to not buy into the old Statue of Liberty.
Dennis Thornton, starting linebacker on Marshall, ran off the field. Looked like he had some sort of injury there, so he won't be out here for 3rd down and 6. Clayton and Mann in the backfield. Webb out of the shotgun. Downfield incomplete. Ball was old, underthrown. He took a hit. It was intended for Jermaine Morera. It'll bring up a 4th down. Good quarterback pressure by Marshall once again.
And that was Underwood once again who got out there and hit Webb just as he let that ball go. But there was no one to throw to. Marshall's secondary is really playing well right now. Willie Smith and Chris Hawkins at the corners, Keys and Royal. Then they bring Johnson in and Wilkes in as the nickel and dime guys, and they have been doing very well in the coverage.
So Jeff Snodgrass will come out to attempt his first field goal of the day, this from 45 yards. And it is no good. Had the distance, but off to the side. So the Marshall defense does its job. 21-13 K-State. That 8-point deficit holds for the Thundering Herd. Snodgrass tried to cap the drive, but he couldn't get it. When we come back, Marshall and Jimmy Skinner at quarterback will try to bounce back. K-State 21-13, K-State on top of Marshall. There you see the sophomore quarterback, Bernie Morris, with that ice pack on that left shoulder. He was having himself a good game, but then just before the half, well, there comes Marcus Watts.
Yeah, Watts came on the blitz and hit Morris. He landed on that shoulder, and they say that's the problem right now, a shoulder injury. And you see the offense with Morris in there, the production, and now with Skinner in there, the lack of production.
Jimmy Skinner started last week, and now he has to get himself into action. Bradshaw looking for room. Finding it. Crosses midfield. Good block by the wide receiver, Marcus Fitzgerald, the younger brother of NFL star Larry Fitzgerald. And Jimmy Skinner gets some help from his friends.
Yeah,
the quarterback with a nice completion.
Nice little screen pass, but you're going to see Sims come up, the linebacker right here. Has the chance to make the tackle and totally whiffs on it. And that's the speed right there of Bradshaw breaking away, running. And then you saw the block there at the end by number one, Marcus Fitzgerald. And that helps an offense when you can get the ball in the hands of a Bradshaw quickly and then let him do things out in open space.
So a good pickup for Bradshaw. He scored on a 52-yarder like that last week. Now Skinner being flushed, going to keep it himself. Pretty good decision. Picked up some positive yardage.
And then the late flag comes out. And they're gonna get Sims for jumping on the quarterback when he slides. And when you slide, you got to lay off him. I mean, that's the rule they have in effect to protect quarterbacks. And they have that option. If they go feet first, you got to stay off them.
Personal foul. Number 45, illegal helmet contact, 15 yards, first down.
Just one of those things you got to recognize and you got to know and you got to lay off. And it was a costly personal foul as now Marshall will have the ball on the 27-yard line.
And take a look at the end of it. Once that quarterback slides, you have to stay off him. And then you see the leading with the head, and that's actually what was called there against Ted Sims. And it didn't look that flagrant, but you have to call that kind of thing to protect players.
So here comes Marshall, trailing by eight. Just over 2 minutes to go here in the third. That's Marcus Fitzgerald, the other Fitzgerald brother, in motion. Skinner, complete. His big tight end is Jeff Mullins. Well, here's that play that we were talking about, concentrating on as he slides down. And you see Ted Sims.
Sims kind of holding the head down there, but, you know, they could have called that. And he also led with the head, and he also hit a quarterback that slid. So, you know, it's a multiple choice there.
Either way, you got him. Which way would you like to get him? Second down and three after the 7-yard pickup there. New right tackle in the game, by the way, Wesley Jones for Marshall. Skinner, empty backfield, working out of the shotgun. Pressure, then over the middle, complete. Hiram Moore inside the 10. Well, we're talking about K-State wanting to bounce back after last year. Oklahoma wants to bounce back after last week. What do you got, Matt Weiner?
Sooners back on their home field against Tulsa. Adrian Peterson, just 9 carries for 32 yards. Not a great average, but he does punch it in here, and he has passed 2,000 for his young career. As soon as on top, 7-0. At the Big House, it's now 7-3 after a Michigan field goal. Michael Hart has left the game with a leg injury. We'll keep an eye on it.
Thanks, Matt. Marshall here, first and goal. Bradshaw gets the call. Taken down at the 9-yard line. Byron Garvin coming up, making a good play. There's that activity from those defensive backs of the Wildcats, Ray.
Yeah, and that's just Garvin, the corner there, on a corner blitz. He's going to come right away. He's going to show up outside here on this side of the screen. They're going to run right at him, and they got no one to pick him up. You see Shope, the tight end, number 13. He's got to use his eyes better and see that blitz and try to get out there and make a play. But if no one blocks you on a corner blitz, odds are pretty good you're going to make a big play, and Garvin did just that.
Second and goal. Coming to the close of this third quarter, and Marshall with a chance to tie up this ball game. Skinner. Complete to the 5-yard line. Once again, he goes to the tight end, Jeff Mullins, the 6'3", 255-pound senior. Last week, he only had one catch. He's been in the mix a little bit on this drive.
And Mullins, I don't know if the ball was a little too wide for him to keep his feet, but he needs to keep his feet after that catch and try to get more. He just kind of caught the ball and fell down there, and there was more for him there.
Got ourselves a ball game, don't we? Largest crowd ever here in Huntington. The Thundering Herd knocking on the door. Marshall trailing K-State by 8. They upset them 2 years ago. Can they do the same? We'll find out when we come back to Huntington. They're striking up the band here in Huntington, West Virginia, and they hope they'll be playing in moments, celebrating a touchdown. Marshall on a 6-play, 67-yard drive, and now with the ball down at the 5-yard line, empty backfield for replacement quarterback Jimmy Skinner, taking on K-State. Start of the fourth quarter, third and goal. Skinner, he gets some time. Has his options, has his man, but he's short.
All right, now it's decision time.
Sean Lazon, short of the goal line. Got to make that call now, Ray. What do you like?
Well, I like the fact that Mark Snyder didn't even hesitate. As
no,
soon as
sir.
He saw where the ball was, he started pointing into the end zone saying, we're going for this. They're playing to win here at home.
Fourth and goal from the one, trailing by 8 against perennial power Kansas State. This is a Marshall program that's had so much success, but admittedly was looking at this year as a little bit of a rebuilding year. Biggest crowd in the history of this stadium, and they'll explode if they get it here. Bradshaw, he's in.
Now the question is, do you go for 2? And I say no, you do not go for 2 yet. There's a full quarter left to play. Kick your extra point, get it to within 1. That way, if Kansas State scores, it's still a 1-possession game. We'll take a look and see if he got in here. You see the surge by the offensive line, and then Bradshaw clearly breaks the plane right there. I like that call. That's definitely a touchdown, but I don't like the going for two right here.
Ray, I got to be honest with you. I do. You're an underdog in your home stadium, biggest opponent that's ever come to town. You can tie up the game, and if you don't get it, hey, be an optimist. You can still win it on a field goal 22-21.
I just don't think it's sound thinking. I think it's an emotional decision.
Chubb Small is in for Bradshaw, but Skinner looks to throw. Two-point conversion. Corner of the end zone.
Boy, this should be a flag. Yeah, definitely should be a flag because that was interference the whole way.
Ryan Baldwin facing up with Hiram Moore, and Marshall's going to be that much closer on their next two-point try.
And now I would go for two. Just because the ball now is going to be at the 1.5-yard line, it opens up the possibility of the running game and the bootleg.
Pass interference on the defense, number 3. Penalty is accepted. Half the distance to the goal. We'll try to make the try again.
Yeah, I definitely think now that you have that extra yard and a half, it changes the whole line of thinking. But you're going to see Moore, number 7 right there. He's just going to run to the corner, and you see Baldwin getting the hand on him and keeping the hand on him the whole way. And that is definitely obvious pass interference.
Ryan Baldwin, the sophomore for St. Louis. He's a young man. It's a graphic design major. Drew up a good-looking training camp, but didn't paint a pretty picture that time defending on that two-point conversion.
See, they set the ball. You can put the ball on either hash or inside either hash, and Marshall chose to move it to the left side, which usually means they're going to run over to that wider side of the field.
And Bradshaw's back in now. Number 44, the lone back. Very effective runner. Skinner drops back to the corner again, looking for Fitzgerald, but he can't find him.
Oh, I don't like that play call a bit. You're a yard and a half out. I think you have two options at that point. You ride the horse that got you there, Ahmad Bradshaw. You hammer him up the middle, or you bootleg off of it. But to run a fade route from the 1.5-yard line, I think is a suspect play call.
Here's a look at it. You can see Marcus Fitzgerald trying to get that little bump.
Well, it's a pick route, you see, and the guy that got picked was Fitzgerald.
Exactly.
Snyder wanted a call, but there was not holding on that. That was just poor execution on the pick route.
Ahmad Bradshaw came up with the touchdown moments ago. Marcus Fitzgerald didn't have a chance there at the two-point conversion. Let's check in with Janine Edwards. Janine.
Well, Joe, as Mark Snyder told us yesterday, he did want to celebrate his first win as a head coach, which was last week. And he went back to his office and he was doing his post-game TV show. And then he was sitting there looking around thinking, where is everybody? He said he wanted a hug. He wanted to celebrate, but his wife and kids were nowhere to be found. Evidently, they were not allowed in the building by some kind of a mix-up. They didn't have credentials, and he said so his wife and kids got in the car and went home. So a kind of anticlimactic last week for Mark Snyder. If he were to be able to pull it off and win today, he said his wife and kids definitely have credentials, and they will be allowed in, and they're here at the game.
I have a feeling that that was cleared up pretty solidly this week, Ray.
You know, all the guy wanted was a hug.
Yeah, exactly. You know, just a little love,
just
Ray.
Just a little love.
A little love, you get your first win in D1.
And there he was, sitting alone in his office, hugging himself, I guess.
Pooch kick here now for Marshall. Fielded at the 20-yard line by Davin Dennis. And he's cutting all the way back to the right side and then finally hauled down at the 32-yard line. We got a good game here in the fourth quarter, and coming up, more college football action here on ESPN. South Carolina and Georgia, what a week DJ Shockley had last week. 5 touchdown passes. Then at 9, you can see number 5 LSU and number 15 Arizona State. Of course, LSU's opening game was postponed due to Hurricane Katrina. Now the Tigers, all that talent, head out to the desert to take on Arizona State tonight. Should be a great full day of college football.
Yeah, Arizona State is no slouch.
Sam Keller at quarterback put up 60-plus points last week against Temple. Of course, a lot of talent in that defensive backfield for LSU. Here's Webb now. Trying the middle. Flag comes down as Webb crosses to the 36-yard line, but I think you're going to get a holding on the interior of that Kansas State offensive line.
Yeah, and I think it's going to be on Matt Boss, the right guard. Let's seeing a lot of that in the second half of Webb just handling the ball himself.
Holding. Offense, number 75, 10 yards from the spot of the foul. It remains first down.
Coach Bill Snyder, he's seen 8 penalties go against his team today. 75 yards. That was one of his big 3 keys to coming up with a win against Marshall. Of course, the first time these programs played 2 years ago, Marshall came up with a 27-20 upset. So the focus, trying to avenge that. This is a target game for Kansas State. First down and 20 in a hole. Thomas Clayton can solve that. This time he doesn't. Clayton just picking up 4 yards to Marcus Thomas, who was a linebacker that moved back to defensive end for this game, had the tackle.
And this has been a different Marshall defense since about, I would say, the last 2 series of the first half. They had an interception, and they should have scored on that, but gave the ball up. And then they also had a 3-and-out, and that was the last 2 series of the second quarter. And then since that time, they have played with a newfound confidence. That front 7 is getting after things.
Second and 15 now for Webb. Better protection for him this time. Now he's just taking a lot of time, and his options becoming more limited. And he scurries out of bounds at the 32-yard line, picking up 5 yards. Big Juan Underwood making his presence felt. Big number 99.
But you know, the protection was actually solid.
Can only go so far.
But the coverage was outstanding. And Webb is finding it difficult to get an open receiver, in particular when they're doing the 5-and-7 step game.
Pretty significant third down coming up here. 3rd and 10 now.
And the crowd is kind of buying into it right now. They realize this is a huge one, and their defense is playing well.
There was one point where you see that third down graphic. It listed it at 6-for-6, but K-State 0 for their last 4 on third down conversions. Can they finally break that streak right here on 3rd and 10? 3 receivers to the top side for Webb out of the shotgun, dancing around. Now back to the right side, ground ball.
Boy, just nowhere to go with it, and then Floyd Wright shows up with the pressure, the relentless pass rush, and knocks Webb to the ground as he lets it go. But this is just solid team defense across the board for the Herd right now. They've got great coverage downfield, and then they're bringing the pressure. Now they're just coming with 4, and Webb, you see, is going to have time. Kind of gets flushed a little bit, and then the guy staying with the play and continuing to hustle is Floyd Wright. He gets the hit on the quarterback.
So Tim Rayer into punt, back deep for Marshall is Chubb Small. Bounces just short of the 30 and then takes a K-State bounce inside the 20. Been a very interesting game. 55-yard punt. Marshall gets the ball, only trailing by 2 when we come back. Joe Tessitore and Ray Bentley with you. Kansas State up 21-19, but Marshall coming on strong, especially on the last drive offensively. Jimmy Skinner in at quarterback for the injured Bernie Morris, and he was finding his targets. Hit Hiram Moore there, and then kept moving the ball towards the goal line. Lazan brought it down to the 1. It was 4th down when Ahmad Bradshaw came up with this.
Just an amazing transformation for Skinner, who started out very shaky. You see, he was 2 of 7 going into that last drive, and then bam, all of a sudden he heated up, 6-for-6 for the 52 yards and got him into the end zone. It just took a little while for Skinner to get going, and you see Larry Keck, the offensive coordinator, up in the box calling those plays, and I think maybe it took him a minute to get adjusted to having Skinner in at that quarterback position. But right now, the 2 of those are meshing very well.
Larry Keck was the interim head coach after Bob Pruitt retired, and there was that gap during spring practice until Mark Snyder took over with just a practice to go. Of course, he was the offensive coordinator during the Randy Moss days of Marshall. Oh, that batted down. And let's check in with Matt Weiner, get an update as to what's going on with Wisconsin. Matt?
A lot of Wisconsin going on at Wisconsin against Temple today. This is Brandon Williams settling under the Temple punt. And that was Brandon Williams breaking a tackle straight up the middle. 3 Owls got hands on him. Nobody got him. 66 yards goes the other way. Notre Dame touchdown coming up next.
Wisconsin all over Temple after Arizona State blasted them last week. Good defensive play by Brandon Archer moments ago. Batting the ball away brings up a second and 10. Marshall trailing by two here in the fourth quarter. Skinner out of the shotgun. He's got time. Denny's pressure. And now that's one of those coverage sacks there, Ray. Had his options in front of him. Looking. And the only thing he saw was big number 56 and number 92. Tierris George and Quentin Echols.
Yeah, Tierris George is the guy that got here first. And George is fortunate that he didn't get a penalty. Right here you see him slap the quarterback in the head. Sometimes they will call that. You're not allowed to hit the quarterback in the head or above the shoulders like that. But they let him get away with that one.
Brings up a third down and 14. Second sack for K-State. Each team with two sacks so far today. You see the numbers on Tierris George. He's the best speed rusher on K-State. Only had one tackle last week against Florida International. Third down. Long pass. Downfield. Thrown to the inside and short. Matt, what's going on with ND in the big house?
Well, the Irish have been able to move the ball. Second scoring drive of the game for them goes 12 plays, 72 yards. Brady Quinn, all time, all kinds of time to throw. It is tipped, and then Jeff Samardzija makes the grab in the end zone. Irish up 14-3 in Ann Arbor.
You know, there was a lot of analysis heading into this Notre Dame-Michigan game, and the one thing that I think held true is that the Michigan defense is very suspect, but we know they can score. Here's the punt now. Jermaine Morera way back, turns around all the way at his 32, and is taken down there. Boy, Sorrell Davis, actually Chris Hawkins, has been playing decent coverage here and came up with a nice tackle there. So K-State will have the ball back, 52-yard punt. Mark Snyder right in it, looking for the big win. His second game as Marshall head coach. More when we come back.
ESPN2's College Football, brought to you by the all-new Hyundai Sonata. A Hyundai like you've never seen before. And Wolverine. Boots, shoes, apparel, gear. Relentless by nature.
A lot to be happy about for the record-setting crowd here at Edwards Stadium. 21-19, K-State. Jim Collins, the first-year defensive coordinator for Marshall, boy, has really clamped down against this K-State offense. One time he was the recruiting coordinator for Steve Spurrier at Florida. He's making the most with seven new starters up front. Allen Webb for K-State. Back to pass. Now looking to run. Beats the man to the outside and gets out of bounds right at the 40-yard line. Missed tackle was Chris Royal. Tried to come up and make the play. Dante Newsome.
Yeah, Royal was kind of the spy in that situation. They've been using him in that role a lot where he's just kind of coming up with underneath coverage, but he's keeping an eye on Allen Webb because he runs so much, and Webb beat him to the corner there, but it did buy enough time to limit the game.
6-yard pickup for Webb, the junior from Denver, Colorado. Ran for over 100 yards twice last year. Started his college career at Indiana, then transferred to K-State. Here's Thomas Clayton, so dangerous when he gets out there. But a good tackle, only a 2-yard gain in Chris Royal coming up with the stop against Thomas Clayton. Look at the Marshall defense.
Yeah, look at that. In the first quarter, they gave up 13 points and 125 yards. Since then, just 8 points and 117 total yards allowed. It's been night and day from the start of this ball game. Jim Collins' defense has really grown up here. You know, and we talked to Mark Snyder about that. You'll see a lot of improvement from game one to game two. We said, Coach, are you going to get that with this group? He said, I hope so. I'm still trying to figure out these guys a little bit, but I hope so. Well, his hopes came true.
Third and two. Webb rolling out, looking downfield. Had an open receiver, but it falls incomplete, intended for his tight end, Norwood.
Boy, Norwood was wide open, coming across from the backside. And Webb didn't see him until it was too late, and then he had to hurry the throw, and that led to his inaccuracy.
And Jim Collins, the defensive coordinator, stops him again. Threw it behind him, Ray.
Yeah, and and Norwood tried to make an argument that he caught that football, but the fact was he caught it right off the ground. That's just not a good catch. Good call by the official.
Brayer to punt. Chubb Small calling for the fair catch, and he gets it at the 24. Joe Tessitore and Ray Bentley with you from Huntington, West Virginia. Hey, Marshall, a team that, of course, has had stars through the years and so much success, but hey, they came in underdogs today. This is a team that knew their limitations, and Coach Mark Snyder said, I didn't realize how inexperienced we were. They're looking like they're gaining experience and gaining confidence as this game goes on.
Great confidence, and they're getting excellent experience in this thing. And the thing that impresses me is the way the defense has grown up here right before our eyes. And they've done it not only in the secondary, where they were pretty solid, but up front. That front seven has really turned it up a notch.
So first down for Jimmy Skinner. Goes to Bradshaw, and that's exactly what Ahmad Bradshaw can give you. He is shifty, and he's got those wide legs with that low gravity and can make those sweet moves, Ray.
I don't know if he rides horse in the offseason or what,
he's
got the widest feet that I've seen. Watch his feet, how close they stay to the ground. Look at the width that he keeps with his feet. He even runs with his feet wide, and when they stay wide like that, that keeps his feet close to the ground, and it also gives him the ability to make cuts. And he really runs a lot like Barry Sanders used to run, and it's so hard to tackle a guy when he keeps that balance and he's so low to the ground like that.
Second and two after that 8-yard pickup. Bradshaw again close to the 35-yard line. First down, Tierris George with the tackle. But Bradshaw off to a good start on this drive.
We'll watch his feet again. Look at the wide stance that he has. He gets up here, and look at him. He gets those feet wide and straddles a little bit, and that allows him to make the cut either way he goes. The other thing he has that goes with the feet is the vision, and his eyes are closely tied to his feet. And when you have that kind of thing going on, you can make outstanding runs.
Looked like he was banged up a little bit at the end of that play, but he stays in the game as they move the formation again. Two receivers to the top, one to the near, and Skinner, who came in replacing the much heralded sophomore quarterback Bernie Morris, who left with an injury, is out of the shotgun. Skinner downfield. It is complete, and what a nice catch by Marcus Fitzgerald, the sophomore from Minneapolis, who is the younger brother of Arizona Cardinals wide receiver Larry Fitzgerald.
Boy, he showed you the strength that he has right there, fending off the defender and coming up with the football. But this is the seam right here. He's going to get to the seam, and that's exactly where they're throwing the football. Skinner's going to throw this to a spot. You see how far outside the seam that Fitzgerald is? He comes back into the seam to make the catch, and that's a very effective pass route for this herd offense.
Of course, his older brother was the 2003 Heisman Trophy runner-up. And Larry Fitzgerald can definitely make an impact on this offense. Like that. Matt Weiner's got an update on Cincinnati, Penn State. Matt?
All right, let's get to Happy Valley. Michael Robinson knocking on the door.
Robinson built the ladder.
Off the play action, off his back foot with a man in his face, finds Patrick Hall. Nittany Lions leading 14-3 at the break. Boston College trailed on their home field 7-0. They've gone 20 unanswered since and leaded 27 unanswered.
So Marshall marching here thanks to the younger Fitzgerald brother, Marcus Fitzgerald.
And he's right up there in the slot. Keep an eye on him. They'll keep going to him.
Trailing by two against Kansas State. Biggest name opponent that's ever come here. Bradshaw down to the 22-yard line. You talk about a guy who needed to step up and did step up. How about Jimmy Skinner, the quarterback who came in just before the half? And what a turnaround after his first seven attempts, Ray.
Yeah, a little shaky when he first came in there, and things were out of sync a little bit. But since then, they have settled in, and they are Larry Keck, the offensive coordinator, is doing a nice job of calling Jimmy Skinner type plays, and Skinner has responded.
Nice to have depth at the quarterback position, no matter what level of football you're playing. Marshall's blessed. Out of the shotgun on second and eight. Skinner to Fitzgerald. This a short pattern, so it'll bring up a third down. Brandon Archer, the outside linebacker, was on the coverage of Marcus Fitzgerald.
Oh, and another catch by Fitzgerald with a defender draped all over him. You see, he's in the slot here. He runs to the sideline and then knows that things aren't happening, runs out of room there, and comes back to help his quarterback. And then his physical presence, he's able to catch the football with a defender hanging all over him. This kid's going to be a star.
Third down and five. Line to make is over the 10-yard line. Pressure. Bradshaw wide open. Ahmad Bradshaw diving down. The ball comes loose. The question is it a turnover? Yes. Oh, boy.
And that's
two
Watts.
Fumbles inside the five-yard line.
Both caused by Marcus Watts. He ripped the fumble out earlier from Matt Morris. This time, he gets this one and rips it out.
This time it was Bradshaw. Before it was Matt Morris, but that is two times that Marshall has been marching down the field, completed a pass inside the five-yard line, only to see Marcus Watts, number two, the free safety, knock the ball loose. And I don't know if the crowd likes this call, though, but nonetheless.
Well, I tell you what, it can be reviewed, and it looked to me on that replay that the ball came out when he hit the ground, and if that's the case, then it should not be a fumble. But that's got to be stopped.
No, that's a fumble, Ray.
Is it?
That's a fumble.
All right, I'll give you that one.
Thomas Clayton, if you take a look just before he comes down and lands on the ground, you can see Ahmad Bradshaw so upset. But watch this, Ray.
All right, we'll take another look at it. You see, all right, he's airborne right now. And that ball does come out before it hits the ground.
So two heartbreaking, costly fumbles. Bernie Morris, the injured starting quarterback, he can't believe it.
And they thought they were going in to go ahead in this ball game here in the fourth quarter. And then Marcus Watts forces his second fumble of the day.
Porter had the recovery. This is Thomas Clayton. Clayton out to the 9-yard line. It'll bring up a third down. Well, maybe the Marshall defense can come up with yet another stop.
Well, they've been playing off the charts since after that first quarter. And now they're trying to get the crowd to help them out a little bit.
This Kansas State team is filled with such offensive talent in terms of speed. Thomas Clayton and Jordy Nelson and Herrera and Figures. But somehow, some way, this undermanned Marshall defense with seven new starters this year in the front seven is clamped down for the past three quarters. Third down and five. Webb rolling to his right. Cuts back, now looking to run. If he can get a block, he's going to get it with ease. He does. Really nice play by the athletically gifted Allen Webb, and a flag comes in from the far side very, very late. Good block by the left tackle, Jeremy Cleary, on that play for Webb.
Well, that was good defense, but it's so hard to contain a scrambling quarterback. And if you've got a guy like Allen Webb, he can make something out of nothing, which is exactly what he did.
Sideline warning on Marshall. That's it first.
So a critical first down converted for Kansas State.
And this is all Allen Webb right here, because everybody's covered down the field. You see, you got color on color up here. There's nowhere to go. And all of a sudden, Allen Webb shows you the athleticism. And then he's got guys that continue to block and run out there. Clary got one for him. Norwood stayed with the play for him, and they kept the drive alive.
And Clary, the team captain, the big senior from Mansfield, Texas, out in front there. Here's Thomas Clayton. Out to the 24-yard line, a pickup of five. Chris Royal, number 26, in on the tackle.
I think that's one of the big adjustments that the Marshall defense made. They started bringing those safeties up to help against the run a little bit more, and that's Curtis Keyes and Chris Royal have come up and done a nice job of making solid tackles and getting involved at or near the line of scrimmage in the running game.
Keep in mind, Kansas State trying to avenge the upset from 2 years ago. Coach Bill Snyder had his team ranked sixth in the country back in 2003 when Marshall came to town and upset them. Now they're trying to hold on for a win here at Marshall. Timeout, K-State. When we come back, K-State try to get the offense going. Stay with us, 21-19 Wildcats. Joe. Joe Tessitore, Ray Bentley, Janine Edwards with you in Huntington, West Virginia. So glad you joined us for what has turned out to be a very interesting and entertaining game. 21-19 K-State, perennial BCS contender here on the road at Marshall, facing a second down incomplete. Allen Webb looking for Jermaine Marrera. You know, Ray, you got to put this into perspective. BCS conference teams have avoided playing at Marshall. Nobody wants a part of this Division I AA team that grew up to 1A and put out all these NFL stars. Now they get their first taste of it. This crowd has come. They've reacted. The largest crowd ever, just short of 37,000. Great atmosphere. A 10:30 in the morning nationally televised game. They have risen to the occasion with an undermanned defense, and Coach Mark Snyder, in just his second game at the helm, looking for an upset. K-State by two, trying to hold on, third and five. Webb looking for the screen pass. He has Marrera, but does Marrera have the first down? Extra effort, yes.
Boy, and they had him stopped short of it. The tackle momentum carried him on.
Matt Weiner, what do you have for us?
Joe, Boston College and Army, and check out how the Golden Eagles got their final points. Quentin Porter lost the snap, found it, sends it out to Will Blackman. Remember, Blackman's a converted cornerback, now a receiver, and two-way Will is on his way. He goes 41 yards, didn't even see the end of it, 27-7.
Will Blackman may be one of the fastest players in the entire country. Here's Thomas Clayton, one of the fastest players on K-State. 9-yard gain. Dante Newsome cut him down.
Let's go back to that first down play, and you're going to see Marrera catch this ball in a hustling Underwood. Number 99 is going to make the tackle, but in doing so, he carries Marrera past the first down yardage marker. And so even though Marshall had the good defense, they kind of helped out a little bit in allowing that K-State first down.
You know, Marrera is just one of those football players.
Gets it done.
He's going to gain yardage. He's going to give you the most he can give you. Just like this man. Fumble! Thomas Clayton, big gainer, and then a fumble. Marshall ball. The initial call was Marshall ball. Let's see if that holds. K-State ball.
Yeah, when they wind the clock, that means it's K-State's football. And you saw Jordy Nelson pointing right away. He saw the recovery, but this is a close one here, and that's going to make Bill Snyder awful nervous. But here comes Clayton, and he gets a nice hole initially, kind of cuts through there, and you're going to see the ball pop out right there, and that was a big hit from Curtis Keyes, who knocks it loose. And Kansas State is fortunate that they come back up with that football.
First referee that came in started pointing the other way, and then all of a sudden they cleared the pile and found Thomas Clayton had the ball. So a big, big play for Thomas Clayton. Gained the yardage and then recovered his own fumble. And now K-State is in prime position. They have crossed midfield. Webb now looking things over. Junior quarterback trying to manage the last 3 minutes and 45 seconds here and hold on for a win or add to the lead. Here's Clayton. Shifty running back. Has his feet under him. Still going. And then finally taken down at the 27-yard line. A 21-yard gain for Thomas Clayton. He is going to be a great football player. He already is a great athlete.
Well, give the credit to the line up front. They hadn't been able to get much going with the running game, and now here with the game on the line late, they're going to get things going and open up a hole right there. You see Clayton just barely gets touched, but he's already 5 yards down the field, stumbles, regains his balance, and makes the huge gain off to the left side.
Now, Thomas Clayton, Ray, 24 carries, 149 yards on the day, and that was still considering what was a dormant offense for K-State for about a quarter and a half. He started hot, and now he looks to finish hot. Webb, inside handoff this time, not able to get back to the original line of scrimmage.
And Matt Couch, the linebacker, came on the blitz there and shot through the gap untouched and made the big tackle for the loss.
And, Ray, not only are they advancing the ball, but that clock keeps winding down. We're under 3 minutes.
Marshall has all three timeouts remaining. But I think it's a little early yet to start using it. Now, you might see one if they get them stopped here on third down and it's a third and longer type situation, I think then you could go ahead and use one.
Coach Mark Snyder, second game as Marshall head coach. He's looking to pull something off here defensively. Second down and 10, the 11th play of the drive. And those thunder clapsticks are out for the thundering herd. And K-State is going to use their last timeout.
Yeah, they were running out of time. Ran out of time on the play clock. And rather than take a penalty in this critical situation, they opted to use that final timeout.
So they will talk things over. Allen Webb has led the way for K-State on this drive. Let's visit with Janine Edwards. Janine?
Well, Joe, I just got word from some Marshall officials. They are extremely proud of their students today. Part of a Bring a Buck program that the student government initiated. Hold on to your hats, guys. They have raised over $520,000 today for disaster relief for Hurricane Katrina. He said they're still counting, and they're just blown away by the amount, by the generosity of the people. Another hurricane connection here in our game is field ref Tony Meyer is from Metairie, Louisiana. He evacuated his family out of the area when the hurricane hit. He said his house is full of 3 feet of water, and he said he's lucky he has so many friends that have been so generous that he's been staying with friends, but he said his house is not livable right now.
Great story, Janine. You know, I think everybody in college football has really stepped up in the course of the past 2 weeks and shown the brotherhood that this sport is so proud of and helped out with this horrible disaster our nation's dealing with. Second down and 10 for K-State coming off the timeout. Webb being pressured, still looking. Pressured again. Turns around. How did he stay up? Finally, he goes down. Floyd Wright was the one who got him, but you got a glimpse of the athleticism of Allen Webb. It was a 2-yard loss.
He looked like Houdini. He had more escapes than Houdini on that one play. But the relentless pressure from Marshall finally overcame Webb's maneuverability. Look at him. He causes one miss. He's looking around, causes another miss, spins again, says, where am I? And finally, the Marshall defense is able to close in on him. That all stems from the coverage down the field, because Webb, he's got time initially, but then the coverage is too good, and then it breaks down.
Well, we had breakfast in Huntington to start the day where we had hash browns, but our couch potato Saturday continues. ABC Sports, of course, will have regional coverage at 3:30, and then tonight at 8 Eastern. Boy, does it get better than this. Number 2, Texas. Number 4, Ohio State. A game that will greatly affect the BCS down the stretch of this season. You can see Texas getting 4 first-place votes already this season. They are number 2, Ohio State number 4. I mean, 2 historically grand programs and the first ever meeting between them. You know, a lot of people say a game that may determine the early front runner for the Heisman Trophy. If Vince Young or Ted Ginn can jump out and have an explosive effort in such a showcase game.
Yeah, but I think more importantly, it may go a long way in determining who will not be the national champion.
Exactly. But if you're going to suffer a loss, better to suffer it early. Right now, Kansas State wants to avoid just that. 2:07 to go. Third down and 12. They're only up by 2. Thomas Clayton in the backfield with Allen Webb.
They had success running screens to Clayton early in the game. See if they go back to that.
He's so dangerous any which way he touches the ball. Webb. Downfield complete for a first down to the 5-yard line. To Jermaine Moreira, 24-yard pickup for Moreira.
Boy, and that showed you the strength of Allen Webb's arm, because he threw a rope at 30 yards and stuck it right to Moreira's chest. Watch this shot that he throws. He's going to step into it and zing. That ball is coming, and it's perfectly thrown. Hawkins didn't even have the chance to break on the ball and make a play. And you see Webb hangs in there and pays for it. Takes a nice shot on that one from Davis as he lets it go, but hung in there and made the key throw on a third and very long.
What a huge play from Allen Webb, and Jermaine Moreira steps up again. He's off to a good start this season. So now K-State from the 5. Clayton Flag comes in as Clayton surges ahead for just about a yard and a half. Matt Couch was able to wrestle him down.
Looked like Jordy Nelson, the man in motion, went towards the line of scrimmage.
That's a no-no. 1:39 to go. Mark Snyder.
And Nelson, when he went down there, he was crackback blocking. And when you run a crackback, you got to make sure you can see the man's number on the front of his jersey before you hit him. And Marrera did not do that, hit the man in the back, an illegal crackback block.
Bill Snyder watching his team methodically move down the field, taking time off the clock. Play after play, they converted that big third down. And Allen Webb now facing a first and goal from the 15. You see the 12-play, 91-yard drive. And remember, he had that nice play to convert the first down on the run when they were pinned against their own goal line. And here he's running again.
And Carson needs to start using their timeouts.
Chris Royal wraps him up.
They should call one right now.
Time is of the essence. That was only first down. Take a look at the costly turnovers for Marshall.
Yeah, and this one's on the kickoff return. Hawkins loses that ball, and they would have been in great field position had he not lost that one. This is after a turnover, and this is Morris here, and he gets stripped by Marcus Watts, who has caused two of these fumbles, and here comes Watts again, and this time he hits Bradshaw, who's getting very close to the end zone for the goal. What would have been a go-ahead touchdown, Watson knocked it out again, and he's had a heck of a ball game. And you look at Marshall, and they have had ample opportunity to go ahead and take control of this football game, but they've kind of hurt themselves with those turnovers.
You know, there's that old axiom, the old theory in football, that a turnover is the equivalent to 60 yards. You get a turnover, it's like throwing 60 yards out the door. In this case, two of those turnovers were like taking 14 points right off the board.
Well, at least 6 points if they just get the field goal.
Exactly.
And a six points would put Marshall ahead right now.
So costly turnovers for Marshall, but give Kansas State credit. Allen Webb, the junior from Denver, Colorado, who you see right there, when he needed to step up, when he needed to get the big drive and take time off the clock, he did it. Want to remind everybody, coming up next, CSU and Minnesota after the conclusion to this entertaining game here in Huntington, West Virginia. Looking forward to that one with the Golden Gophers and the Rams. Second and goal now. Penalty brought him back. Here's Clayton. To the right side, want to stay in bounds.
Got out of bounds.
You got to stay in bounds.
Huge error by Clayton. He needs to go down. You can see Victor Mann, the fullback, telling him you got to go down in that situation. And that's just a young back not fully aware of all the things. And now he had a chance to go down as well. And that saves Marshall their final timeout.
And now this third down is huge, Ray.
Right there. Go down, young man.
Because if they can come up with a stop on third down, and even if the ball is kept in play so that the clock would be running, they use the timeout. They force a fourth down situation with K-State. They're getting the ball back.
Yeah, that's a critical error by Thomas Clayton, and I guarantee you he will be told about that many times.
If he had stayed in bounds, Marshall would have had to use a timeout. So this is costly.
Quarterback draw right here.
Flag comes in.
Boy, you see Allen Webb just upset with his offense.
Prior to the snap, delay of game on the offense number 8. 5-yard penalty remains third down.
We are in Huntington, West Virginia. K-State, the perennial BCS contending power, coming to Marshall, the largest crowd to ever attend a game here at Marshall, the biggest name opponent. I'm Joe Tessitore alongside Ray Bentley and Janine Edwards. Thomas Clayton, a star for K-State, but it's all come down to this. 1:08 to go, K-State by 2, and it'll be third and goal from the 15-yard line. Can K-State, with all that young speed and talent, get it in? Can this undermanned Marshall defense come up with a stop? Here's your answer. Screen pass, Marrera, nothing doing. Fumbled the ball.
And Marshall comes up with it.
The Thunder has arrived. 58 seconds to go, and the Thundering Herd, Juan Underwood, came up with it, and they will have their chance to ignite this record-setting crowd.
And the thing about that is all they need is a field goal now to win this one. Had K-State held possession of the ball, they had a chance to kick that field goal and go ahead and make Marshall have to score a touchdown. But that's not the case now.
Well, they missed a two-point conversion that would have tied it up 21-21. But the defense was able to hold after a dramatic, sensational drive by Allen Webb and the K-State offense. But all of a sudden, when it was time to step up,
Chris Terrell's the guy who knocked that ball loose, and then Underwood recovered it.
Big play by the Marshall defense. And now Jimmy Skinner, who came off the bench just before the half to replace the injured Bernie Morris, has his moment in the sun. Complete to the 25-yard line. But I'll tell you what, Ray, dink and dunk ain't getting it done.
That's wasting the time right there, and they got to hurry up. Marshall does, and either they have a play called right now or they got to spike the football. But they should be getting a play in.
And only
they
one timeout left, right?
They get a play in, but they're wasting a lot of precious time right here.
Well, look at the clock, because that play is taking 25 seconds. They just got 2-3 yards, and it took 25 seconds to accomplish that.
Yeah, Skinner
downfield.
Should have thrown it away instead of dumping it off to the receiver there.
Jimmy Skinner, last week he started. He was only 11 of 17 for 98 yards. He was sitting on the bench today and then called into action when Bernie Morris went down. He started off really rough, choppy waters. Then all of a sudden, he started finding his stride. Now, he needs to find some magic. Third down and 7, only 28 seconds to go, and he's sitting back at his own 27-yard line. There's Morris. Three receivers out of the shotgun is Skinner.
He's got to throw it down the field in this situation. Only 28 seconds left.
And preferably towards the sidelines. Down the field indeed. Almost a great catch by Fitzgerald, but good coverage by Justin McKinney, and just not enough for Marcus Fitzgerald, the younger brother of Larry Fitzgerald, the star NFL receiver.
It's that same little seam route we saw earlier. Good throw, and Fitzgerald should have caught that ball. Nice play by McKinney coming over the top and kind of knocking it out of there at the end. It's fourth down now.
The line to make is the 34, but those 22 seconds are huge there. But if they don't get it to the 34, doesn't matter how much time's left on the clock. Skinner from the shotgun. Fourth and 7. First down, Marshall. Hiram Moore out to the 47.
And they got to get up there and spike the football. They got to get lined up. The clock will start once the chains get set. And they don't want to waste that last timeout. They want to save that for their field goal try. So they're going to spike the football immediately here.
Fortunately, the clock stops on a first down in college football, so they have that opportunity to do that right there. 14 seconds remaining. They may add another second to that clock. Marshall trailing K-State by 2.
You see Ian O'Connor, the field goal kicker, over there on the sideline.
Made a 44-yarder, made a 21-yarder, and missed a 47-yarder.
And he's got to have a little bit of the case of the nerves going right now, just hoping that he gets a shot. They say his range is about 47. They're comfortable with it.
Talked to Mark Snyder about that yesterday. He actually tried a 52-yarder last week that he missed. 14 seconds to go. Skinner downfield again. He's got a man. Hardwood, unbelievable, and he's out of bounds. They don't even need to use the timeout. Unbelievable. What a play from Jimmy Skinner. 33 yards. Wilbur Hargrove with the reception.
And Kansas State blitzed on that play, and I question that, because now you leave your secondary out there in man-to-man coverage, and look at the blitz. They bring in all these guys up here, and now you got coverage issues, and it's just a corner route. And what a nice route by Hargrove, and then the perfect throw from Skinner. And now they have to manage the clock in terms of when do they want to take this timeout. And what I think they'll do is they'll run the ball and get it right into the middle of the field, call the timeout, and then bring on O'Connor and try to win this ball game.
8 seconds to go. Marshall still with a timeout, trailing by 2.
They better hurry. They're going to get a 5-yard penalty.
What a fabulous finish here. Whichever way it goes, Skinner deflected and intercepted.
Why?
Justin McKinney with the interception.
I just can't believe that play call. You need to run the football to the middle of the field and set up your kicker. To try and get another pass off is just not sound thinking.
They were in field goal range. They could have played conservative. They had the timeout, but they wanted one more.
Boy, that just is mind-boggling to me. Got a hand on the football, and just bad things can happen. They were in position. All they needed to do was get that ball to the middle of the field, use their timeout, and then get O'Connor on the field and try to win one. Mark Snyder's going to second-guess himself on that one.
Former defensive coordinator Mark Snyder just a year ago at Ohio State all of a sudden gets aggressive as a head coach on offense. And K-State takes the knee. The crowd had their thrills, but K-State wins 21-19. Coming up next, college football, Colorado State, Minnesota. For Ray Bentley, Janine Edwards, and our entire crew, I'm Joe Tessitore.